Yeah, he is.
13th. Okay, let's call the Board of Selectmen for December 13th, 2016 to order, it being the appointed hour. And let's start out by with liaison reports. Dan?
Mr. Chairman, just wanted to note that the legal notice was published in yesterday's Chronicle for the two zoning articles related to recreational marijuana that we were discussing, I think, 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
One for the moratorium, one for the prohibition of facilities, i.e. Retail sale. So what that means is when the law attains the enactment date of the 15th, no one can validly seek a permit until those issues have been disposed of with town meeting.
Good. Yes.
I could just add on to that. I don't know all the details, but Wakefield and Linfield have done something very similar, if not identical.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if they've realized the time frame and opened a hearing or published notice. I tend to ask their voters the same kinds of questions next April.
Kevin?
I don't have anything to report per se, but there is an upcoming meeting of interest. On Thursday evening, the Zoning Board of Appeals is meeting with the 40B developer for down Lincoln Prescott. And I think this is going to be their final public meeting, so they have to close the hearing on this Thursday evening. It's going to be at the Pleasant Street Center at 7 p.m. I'm not going to be able to attend it. I think I talked with Barry. Barry may be able to get over there. Which unfortunately I have a family commitment that night that I just can't make it there for. But of interesting note, they are coming back. They've submitted plans to the town that has 1.25 parking spaces. They did so in a combination of things. Part of their parking waiver is going to be, I think, requesting additional, I don't know if it's additional or if it's a new item, but compact spaces. Bob, do you know if it's new or is that additional compact?
No, it's 30% compact space.
Okay. So they did it by, you know, compact spaces. They did it by kind of rearranging it a little bit. They did it by taking the unit down from 72 to 68 units as well to hit that number. Also, as part of that, just recently submitted, I think as of yesterday, his plans from the on-site loading area that looks like now where if you're looking at the building, they had a transformer all the way in the far left on Lincoln Street, and now they're going to ask RMLD to be able to push that well back onto the property to allow for a loading area over there. So
on the property?
On the property.
Sure.
Going to be tight.
And outside the structure, which means there's no height requirement.
Right.
Or height limit, which is good.
So it should be an interesting meeting.
So based on the material that they've sent, are we expecting them to come back to see us?
Not if the ZBA approves that on-site loading.
Did we send a letter to them?
So I've held off to hear this. I do know that, matter of fact, the chair has just walked in the door.
Very timely.
The ZBA, timely, has indicated that the ZBA would like a letter from us. I've sat on that, not to be sitting on it, but to wait till we had all the facts in. And I think I will go ahead with a letter. I mean, there is a certain reality, and that is that there was a, what I would call it, I want to just be sure I'm still on the same page that I thought I was on with all of you, and that was that there was a informal request with an expectation in a short turnaround of a formal request for us to grant space on the public way.
Right.
Correct? I mean, is that the way everybody remembers it?
Mm-hmm.
And we did not get that material, still haven't really, you know, as a board. And so I need to let the zoning board know that it would not be our intention, in the absence of any material, to approve anything. It sounds like now they're not coming.
I would guess from this latest draft that they're going to, you know, try to solve it on site with the ZBA.
Well,
at the Thursday meeting,
anything that would surface after their deadline date, and they've offered no extension, I believe, that we're aware of as this board, right?
But the 15th, to my recollection, Bob, the 15th is to close the public hearing. That doesn't mean, I think they have 40 days still to work with the ZBA thereafter.
Is that your understanding, Dave?
Correct.
The hearing must close on December 15th. The decision must be published with the clerk within 40 days of that date.
So our letter doesn't have to go in by the 15th.
But after the 15th.
Well, our letter needs to be, the ZBA has requested our letter to be on the record.
It really should be there by the 15th.
So, you know, I am going to proceed essentially with the letter that, that we all agreed I would send. I think the only caveat to that is, I think, you know, Kevin's expressed that he feels there was some miscommunication relative to who's here, who wasn't here, and, you know, despite the fact it was an agenda item. So, you know, I'll make note of that.
Sure.
Yeah, yes, John.
John, if you hearken back, not to the miss meeting, but to the meeting prior to that, there was should have been no doubt by anyone in the room or any of the insects on the walls that we were displeased with the content and the spirit in which the meeting was held. So while they might legitimately have said, gee, I didn't hear about the rescheduling, I cannot in my wildest dreams imagine that they did not know that there was going to be a subsequent meeting. And this being one of the bigger deals that they must be managing, I would assume it's one of their primary focuses to get concurrence with the board in terms of resolving the loading dock. Further, I understand one of the principles is, if I understand, chair of the ZBA in Walpole, is that correct, David? So this is a man not unfamiliar with due process, so right. I might grant quarter to somebody who is more junior or more inexperienced. This guy knows what's going on, so I don't really like the thought of being said it's not you, it's us. You know, I don't want to suggest that somehow it's incumbent on us.
The tone of the letter would not be that, John.
Yeah.
You know, but rather than take the task over the second meeting,
yeah.
I think the focus needs to be where we were, mm-hmm. which is that we saw no good cause.
Yeah, I'm still wound back to that meeting where we
parted
ways.
Yeah. So I think that's the content of the letter will reflect that, and I know that the ZBA would like to have a letter from us based on our findings to date, and I think that'll reflect that. Everybody still okay with that?
Yep.
Yes.
Okay. Anything else, Kevin?
That's all I have to report.
Quick follow-up for you, Kevin. Do I understand this tandem parking part of the proposal as well? Is there front-back type parking proposal?
I do not know. I don't recall seeing it on there.
I believe I heard there was, but I don't know if the source knew with authority. But
yeah, do you recall? I can't recall right now, and I don't have the plans in front of me that they submitted.
There were new plans submitted today.
Tonight.
Right. Tonight.
An hour ago.
Yeah, tonight. I haven't had a chance to review those, but the applicant also with that plan submitted a revised list of requested waivers as well, outlining several options, including loading zones, possible loading zones. But to answer your question, I don't recall seeing anything regarding tandem parking to answer your question.
Okay, thank you.
Just a side note, it's not in our purview, but so-called compact parking spaces are generally 6 inches narrower. Put a full-size car in there, doors are going to start banging other cars if they're full-size cars. You can't really control who's going to be parking in those spaces.
Park at your risk.
Yeah.
That sounds like things that the ZBA are going to have to...
CPDC and ZBA, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. John?
I just wanted to thank the town meeting members and those that watched on TV for the special town meeting, which I thought went just about as smoothly as it could have given the circumstance. Difficult topic, lots of questions going back in history, what was said, who, what, when, where, and I thought it was about as positive an ending as I could have imagined. Could have went a lot differently.
Hmm. Yep. Barry.
Yeah, I just wanted to make a comment about the town meeting as well. I agree it went as well as it could have. I think, though, one of the probably the most expensive items that came out of it was not necessarily the $6 million that we don't have to really spare, but kind of what was apparently, was made clear is sort of a deteriorating trust of town government by some folks in the, you know, in the community. And I think the repair of that trust is probably the single most important thing that we as a town government should really be working on going forward. You know, it's, I mean, clearly, you know, the postmortem of this thing really showed that we've already kind of taken the steps to kind of make sure that when it comes time to deal with a Killam school or hopefully a public works garage, that we already have the underpinnings of good governance and procedures in place to make sure that this doesn't happen again. So while it was important to go through all the things that went wrong, I think it's also important to go through all the things that we've taken steps to correct. Through obviously stuff that we're going to talk about later with the permanent building committee, and things that we saw improvements with in terms of the library. But I think going forward that the community is really looking for us to be transparent and to do a better job. And you know, it's I think it's our job to do that. And as we even debate the FY18 budget, where we have a lot of really hard choices to make, that we really need to win back that trust. And I think that I know we can assure that folks on this board are going to work really hard to do that. And I'm glad this thing is now in our rearview mirror. Yeah.
Well, obviously that was the biggest focus. I have not attended any of my liaison responsibilities since our last meeting. Obviously the focus has been strongly on town meeting, and it was spirited. I think people did say a lot of things were on their mind, and I think, you know, it's fair to characterize that there's some questioning about transparency, that, you know, everyone in town government needs to redouble their efforts in that regard as far as I'm concerned. So anything else that we missed? Public comment. Yes, Bob.
Bill Brown. To go along with that, I think town meeting members should get themselves more involved too. And it's an ongoing problem. I talked to Bob about it. 1974 said the same thing. People just don't, town meeting members come there to vote and they don't do anything else. And as you know, I do get harass you guys once in a while.
Well, you know, Bill, I do think that it's, I think that comment fits probably for a lot of people in town meeting, but it certainly doesn't fit for all, and I don't know that it fits for the majority even. I think a lot of people put a lot of energy into that particular topic, others not so much.
What was the average of the meetings? Do you have any idea, Bob?
What do you mean?
Average attendance.
Oh, wasn't that big.
130s, would you say, Laura? 135?
Or were we like 150?
What was attendance through November and December was 122.
And I know we had some 140s.
And the highest attendance was 142. Got 20 difference.
That means you got 70 town meeting members that didn't care.
Yeah. And you have a lot of people that don't come.
Where would we be if 70% of our military said that stayed off?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Point well taken, Bill. Any other public comment? Okay, Bob.
Just one on town meeting. I think at least one or maybe more town meeting members raised an interesting but a very difficult question, and that's how can they participate in litigation? And they can't. So I don't know if this were a issue from this board and my office, what would we have done differently to educate town meeting along the way? I don't know. I hearken back to Rocco's landfill. We brought articles to them 3 different times and had to cancel twice because we just weren't ready to settle.
Right.
So at least we had them educated that something was going on. But it's not like we can invite some representatives of an open town meeting to an executive session.
No.
You can't.
And
so
you
they
know,
asked a fair question. If we are meant to, you know, to be asked to agree to settle the litigation, not just fund it, shouldn't we be involved in some way? And all I can say is the better way to have done it is to have at the beginning of town meeting the agreement ready, which it wasn't, and have them see it, or have them think about it for 2 or 3 weeks as the other town meeting stuff went on, and then ask to vote. That's about all you can do.
Right.
In terms of ongoing litigation, I really see no way other than that being handled properly by an executive board
yeah.
in executive session.
Yeah,
otherwise, you're going to
Well, there really is no provision inside a town meeting for that.
We wasted a lot of time discussing that.
But the dispute, I think, originates from the difference in the word approve. The town meeting has the right to approve the settlement, and approve can be interpreted as draft and help develop the content, or it can be just review and pass or fail, or it can be funded. And Ray's view, as you heard, was you're getting a chance to improve it here by virtue of funding it or not funding it.
Correct.
You've got a yes, no, up, down vote. That's not the assessment of town meeting members. So I think that the other step I would go at is try to clarify what the intent of that language is. What is that? What was approve really meant to me? Meant.
What was the section of the bylaw that Mr. Barnes was citing?
I don't remember.
It'd be worth re-examining that.
Yeah.
I don't know if bylaw can help with that.
Well, I think one of the things that the Board of Selectmen in this particular situation needed to do, you know, in the state of the town, town meeting was advised, was reminded, I should say, of a substantial litigation that was pending. The public record, you know, certainly would have reflected, and it was mentioned, that there were substantial amounts at risk in the cross litigation that was going on. And I actually had a handful of town meeting members talk to me after the meeting who commented on the fact that, you know, they were alerted and had done some of their own research. I mean, to your point, Bill, there's a lot of people that do intense amounts of research, you know, in the background, and I think it's notable when they do that. Whatever side of a situation that they're on, you know, that kind of information is important.
It's interesting, some of the state agencies are far more responsive to inquiries by town meeting members than they are from boards.
Yeah, or employees.
Or employees. As Ms. Phillips, I think, demonstrated.
Bob, anything else?
No, that's all. Thank you. Just okay. The internal borrowing.
Yeah, I think we've got a pretty full agenda here tonight, and I don't think we've got anything kind of in the middle as far as proclamations and appointments and so forth. I think we should move right to the first item and to the point of town meeting to improve the internal borrowing for Reading Memorial High School and TLT settlement.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the internal borrowing in the amount of $3 million for Reading Memorial High School repairs and additions, TLT litigation, as authorized by Article 4 of the special town meeting on December 8, 2016.
Second.
Discussion.
I understand that we're doing this so we can defer the bonding of this actual amount to some point
right.
in the future where it can be combined
some
appropriately
point
with other.
Before July 1st in the future,
letter.
Yes.
September
we,
of the fiscal year.
In addition to combining it, which is economical, we also want to press the MSBA for reimbursement within that time frame so we know how much net we have to
so
bond.
You may not
okay.
even have to
well,
bond
we probably
that.
Will borrow all $3 million, but if something really amazing happened, we might not have to.
Okay.
Bob, did they give a timeline on the MS?
The MSBA does not. They do understand fiscal years, but otherwise, no.
And the other question I have is that, you know, given the interest rate environment that's not becoming favorable to cities and towns to borrow, does it make sense to borrow sooner rather than later? Or does it matter?
It'll depend on what the MSBA says for timing. That's less important. It'll depend on what permission we're going to seek at April town meeting for other borrowing. We haven't quite figured that out yet. There were going to be four other things for water, sewer. I think with the sewer we might just push out. So we might be borrowing in January instead of waiting.
Because it seems like some of those capital projects as a result of this settlement are going to be pushed
in
at least out of the.
In the general fund, yes, no question. But in water and sewer.
Yeah.
You know, the staff has given me an update just yesterday on some infrastructure, and sewer's not as much of a rush, I guess I'll just say.
Okay. So this money will actually come from free cash?
It's sitting in the bank account now. We'll just effectively.
Right. How quickly after the borrowing does that get replenished in free cash?
I think it's 7 days.
7 days?
Yeah.
Okay.
So.
And we are ready to pay by December 30th.
Right. Yeah, that was my next
If they give us
question.
Wire instructions, which they're. Confused
well,
about
they've been, you know, based on.
Oh my God.
Based on the history with the other side.
Right, routing number.
Their attention
to
detail
is it all
weak.
To one place, or
no.
are we sending it to different places?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, those other terms, Bob, that you described, the fact that we would combine it, and I guess it would be would it be temporary debt?
This is temporary debt. When we actually finally borrow, it would be permanent debt whenever we do it.
Do those terms have to be in the article in your?
No.
Bob, you don't have an idea. I mean, I know it's, you can't read the crystal ball, but whether it's January or April, what the cost of our borrowing would be relative to what we just refinanced a while ago. I mean, 50 basis points more,
yeah,
75 more?
Half a percent more. We're still a better credit than the U.S. government.
Yeah, yeah. But that is on the move.
And
Barry
makes
a point. That is on the move. It's
yep.
not, I mean, all the interest rates are on the move.
Yep.
So it does make sense unless there's a real strong reason to delay.
Yeah.
It strikes me that the MSBA, what is it?
MSBA, yeah.
MSBA. They could act quickly and they could drag their feet.
Yeah,
and
as
you
I
know
say,
what? I mean, should we overborrow as a result of that? You know.
Rescind the authorization?
You know, generally speaking, you can't borrow money at this time of year unless it's an emergency. You're going to pay for it. Nobody wants to borrow, buy bonds between now and January 1st.
Right.
But in January, we can borrow. The
yeah.
markets will open again.
Right. Yeah.
So if we have to borrow in January, we
will. We'd never get that kind of borrowing done by
no.
by that time anyway. I mean, that's hence the point of borrowing
right.
from ourselves.
Yeah, we're not meeting again, so
right.
yeah. can't sign the bonds.
Any other discussion? do we need it? We don't need a roll call on this, do
no.
we? All those in favor? Opposed? 5-0, Paul. Okay, so we've invited a number of different, we're going to discuss now the Permanent Building Committee bylaw and some thoughts about that. I know the Building Committee has, Greg, are you guys here in session? Do you have a quorum?
We are in, we have a quorum, so
you're in session.
Order, yes.
Okay. And we also invited, because of the nature of the discussion, the library trustees and the school committee. I can already say that the school committee is meeting itself, so
yeah.
they're previously engaged, so they won't be here tonight. The bylaw committee?
We are here. We have a quorum. We call it 7:23.
Okay. And library. Library representative?
They decided they're only going to build one library, so they were okay with this.
Oh, okay. They won't be building another one soon. Okay. That being the case, I think we're all in order here, so.
Okay. I'm going to give a brief presentation, and then it's mostly meant to be discussion. You can see from the list behind me the members, Greg Stepler, Brad Congdon, John Coote, Pat Tompkins, Nancy Toomey are all here. Michael Bean and Dave Trinella are associate members. So that is the Permanent Building Committee, if you will, the core group. They worked on two very different tracks. One was on the cemetery division space needs, as you know, and the other was to establish a formal process, which they have previewed with you and will review a little bit tonight. The process they've designed in draft form, and they've discussed it several times over the year, has two parts, project assessment and then project administration. And it's important to know those phases are very different. For instance, project administration is when those temporary members come in, not at the beginning. So I'll go into that detail. For project assessment, there's three stages. There's the application process, and they want the bylaw to change to make it very clear that only the three elected boards in town have a right to request a project of them. I think we all imagined that when the bylaw was written, but it wasn't written that way. It just, you know, it never dawned on us that, well, the recreation committee, the way it's written, could come directly to them and ask for a recreation facility. I don't know that that's what you want.
Or town meeting.
Yeah, or town meeting in this case. And they also want to make sure in the application process that, for instance, if the town manager came to them during the library project, which let's say they were managing, and said, you know, we have 1 month to get a grant to build a new town hall. They have the right to say, no, we can't possibly meet that time frame. We're busy. Otherwise, they're reluctant to say no to anything unless it's just physically impossible to hit the time frames.
If they said no, is that the gating factor for town meeting? You can't go to town meeting?
Yeah. And the next step is evaluation. A lot of data work. You know, speaking about the cemetery garage, there had been some past work done. They wanted to gather all the past work, but they wanted to make their own evaluation of it. This is when, if a new project came along, they would want to do site visits and hold stakeholder meetings. And again, going back to the past process, you know, it was important to have stakeholder meetings early in the process. And, you know, this establishes when that would be. So this is well before anything is going to town meeting or, you know, being seen by the community at large.
So just a question on this, on stakeholder meetings. I think one of the unforeseen circumstances of having the permanent building committee work on this, on the cemetery garage, was that they sort of bore the brunt of a lot of community anger,
yep.
so to speak. And so I would hope that, you know, while it is important to do stakeholder meetings early on in the process, that, you know, they're sponsored by the applicant as opposed to them kind of doing it on their own, because it was unfair.
I agree, and let me just clarify, a stakeholder meeting is not necessarily meant to be with abutters. It could be with, for instance, the library trustees to build a new library.
Right.
And then on a parallel track, the library trustees would have an obligation to be reaching out to the abutters.
Right. That's my point. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. They did kind of take on a little of the abuse they didn't deserve.
Yeah, and they don't get paid nearly as much as we do for
that's
that.
True. And as you know from past meetings they've had, they really want to set up a nice formal process and evaluate against established metrics, so it's a quantitative process. When they're finished this evaluation, they felt it was important to address their findings to all boards and the town manager, and to effectively wrap up in a package a presentation for town meeting to be made. So at that point, that's not to say there is a project, but it's ready to go to town meeting to ask town meeting if they think it's a project. And again, they've been independent. It's just the people on the building committee, full-time, if you will, building committee. Once town meeting approves it, then they go into the project administration part. And this is the one where I've had some thoughts that I think we still need to hammer out, but that's clearly when you would appoint the temporary members to represent the stakeholders.
So this is upon approval of design fees or design and construction?
I'm not exactly sure. Let's just say Killam as the example, as a school building that's going to happen in the next 10 years. I don't know where in this process you go to town meeting to ask for design money, but I think it's after you go through the assessment fully and decide, yes, Killam, or there's some project that needs to happen. And then you go to town meeting and you say, we need some money to, at the very least, price out some options, maybe two options, let's say, or however many options you want. I think in here, if you're thinking of process, I think there might be some loops in here, so it's not just a clear shot to the final. You might do something, get information, go back to design again, and do things like that.
But the design approval, Tommy, design funding approval is the gating factor for the appointment of temporary members.
Is that what you'd say? Yeah, I think.
Getting that wrong, yes.
Yeah.
Tina, is your question, when is the milestone when the temporary members that
when is it a project
assistant?
Yeah, when is it a project?
What is that milestone called? Is it defined yet?
I would the way we envisioned it is that we would have the opportunity to evaluate a proposed project, reach a determination on feasibility, get a rough order of magnitude cost, perhaps even have a conceptual design and a conceptual estimate, and have enough information to be able to make a presentation to town meeting that says, here's what we were asked to do, here's what we found, here's what we think in terms of site selection, feasibility, traffic, noise, cost for construction, cost to operate the building, those sorts of things, and then let town meeting discuss and decide whether to proceed down the path of additional funding for further design, further evaluation. To interject an idea too that we've bantered around a couple times is the idea of having some money available to the building committee.
Sure.
And I think in essence what that pot of money would do is allow us to advance a concept, a proposed project a little farther along and make a more educated evaluation than just looking at it internally and saying we think X. With the ability to reach out to design consultants and do some of this analysis, test borings,
sure, you do more discovery,
traffic studies, noise mitigation, those sorts of things, we have a little better idea, even to the point of maybe even having a conceptual design, some floor plans, some material selection, and that way we can have a conceptual cost estimation of what the building would cost, at least as a baseline to be able to make a proposal.
Greg, that all sounds great, and I think the question is it so, would there be a disagreement about that among others? as to when the associate members come into that discussion? Should it be so well defined that it's is unambiguous when that moment is?
Yeah, to follow up on Greg's point, you are going to see a budget this winter that puts $75,000 in the capital plan for what he just talked
exactly.
about every year.
Yes.
So that should allow that money to be spent through the assessment portion to gather some initial facts. So clearly you don't have temporary members during that. Do
right.
we have a project? It's trying to get more information.
Right.
Do we
yeah,
really have a project?
The milestone needs a name, though. I could see yep. dispute over where the associate members claim that there's authority.
The earliest it could be is the next time town meeting is asked to approve money that's not that money right there. That's the soonest it could be. It could
it's
be
not
later.
It's not a project until town meeting says it's a project.
Could those funds be spent after, into the design phase as well, or only in the assessment phase?
It would be spent any way they lawfully can spend it. So it's through Joe's budget.
I mean, the idea of spending a little bit of money up front to save a lot of money
yeah.
at the end.
Perfect sense.
No.
Yeah.
And I think what I would envision in the way that we've talked about it internally is if we had some money to do initial evaluation of a proposed project and put together a recommendation or presentation of a town meeting to act on, part of the amendment, say, from the sponsoring agency, part of that presentation we would make would be to request funding for furtherance of the design and potentially construction. The way we'd written the previous OPM RFP and had intended for that to go was that we would have a design up to some milestone, a cost evaluation, cost estimate for that milestone design, and then from that point at least understand if we are in the range, the target range for construction costs, or if it was just well beyond what we anticipated or well within, in which case we could advance further down the road of design. So that's what we had envisioned the process to be.
And that's more kind of a plus minus 20 or plus 25 minus zero kind of a number at that point, yeah, at best.
Right.
Once a real project is decided on and the funding is acquired, presumably through town meeting, possibly the voters, then you know the PBC is going to ask you some questions about what their role is during construction, certainly, and we can talk a little about the library project as a comparable. And then an important part after a project is done, which eventually the library will be, I'm sure, is to sit down and have a sort of an aftermarket discussion. What did we just learn here? What did we do well? What did we not do well? What can we change? Could we have foreseen some of these things? And I was not able to make the last library building committee meeting, but they voted themselves out of existence. But Joe Huggins and myself and Bob Lebrecht, the OPM, are doing that with the library for sure. There's a lot of things you learn along the way. And the PBC has done a really clear and very thorough job of making sure that whatever it is they do, they leave for their followers and other members on the PBC 10 years from now will have really good records available to them to see what was learned and to see how projects went, which I think is really important. That's something that town government is not always put as a high priority, just we're always busy doing the next
thing.
Yeah. So to sum up in real simple way, the bylaw changes they asked was to have the core group of 5 plus 2 exist only at the beginning and not to add other members between 2 and 4 till much later on in the process, once there is a project, which is hard to define. To have the 3 elected boards only as sponsors, and to actually lower the project cost from $2 million to $1.5 million, because as we learned the hard way, when you have a project that could be $1.5 million, you have to hire an owner's project manager much sooner than you logically would think you need one, and that's just the rules. But it's also, they can decline a project that might be of that value unless it's construction only. So for instance, we had a security system project out there for all the buildings, and we asked them, is that something you guys wanted to look at? Do you think you have expertise? They didn't really think they did as a group. Individually they may, but not as a group. So I think it's important that they be able to pick construction projects only. That's why they're there, not just capital projects that happen to hit a certain size. And the question I heard a lot of during the last year is, what do the selectmen intend, and as a proxy for the other 2 elected boards, what do they intend the role of the PBC to be during construction? Mm-hmm. Surely it's not daily supervisors.
Right.
But what is the role, and I'll...
That actually came up in town meeting the other day.
Yeah, and I'll talk a little about, just very briefly, about the library project, and Paula found the ad hoc formation, and let me just read you some things. The library building committee shall give advice to the town manager on some initial things. Let's see.
Six.
Yeah, monitor the construction process, working with the, at the time, Assistant DPW Director Joe, to determine how the project's tracking. And then without delaying decisions, review and make recommendations to, again, Joe at the time, on change orders. So at every meeting, we reviewed change orders, but I can tell you, on more than one occasion, change orders could not wait for the next meeting. It had to be done, and we just did them. So the construct of this, for better or worse, was Library Building Committee is advisory to who is now the Facilities Director. And the Facilities Director was advisory to me, and I had to make the final decisions. We have what I'll call is, and meaning no disrespect, a more professional group now in the Permanent Building Committee. I think they can rightly be assigned more responsibility, but it's a question of where do you draw that line?
Well, I think the thing that came up in town meeting, and I think it's germane to this discussion, is that you can't ask volunteer committee members
right.
to take on the responsibilities of somebody that should be getting paid to do that.
And you also
can't, it's too much to ask.
No matter how good a job you do in hiring a project manager, you can't rely on them to make all the final decisions
right.
either, because they're not staff.
Right.
Well, I mean, I can envision the building committee meeting once a month, maybe once every 2 or 3 weeks during some heavy construction period to review all these things, and to make those recommendations, but not to be on site on a daily basis. Obviously, if there's things there are, emergency decisions that have to get made, a meeting could get called, relatively quickly. But also, I think one of the best things that the Permanent Building Committee can do is to vet and make sure that we have the best project manager on board. Because, correct me if I'm wrong, but you guys have either been or hired some of the best people in your roles in the past. And then also to make sure that the contract that gets negotiated, working with town council, is ironclad. And then meet periodically and how are we doing? Do we mm-hmm. do we need to tweak this or tweak that or put a little pressure here, put a little pressure there? But again, not to be on site, and the fact that, and to have the committee really be made up of the people who really know it, know their business. So.
Yeah, I would ask, not to put you on the spot, but Nancy and Greg, to just think about if the Permanent Building Committee had been involved in the library, what positive changes could have happened differently, if any? And how could the PBC have acted differently than the Library Building Committee did to be helpful? And Joe, the same question of you is, given a different set of resources, how could they be helpful to you and to the town? I don't have answers for those. I really just asked the question. I think broadly speaking, the library project went well. It had some rocky moments early on for sure, but I think in the last year or two it was good. And it's finishing up as best as a project can, a project that no one cares about anymore from the trades. And eventually they'll finish it. Hopefully this year.
Dan?
Just to add to that, I think maybe what was missing was a better upfront analysis of the options.
Yes, clearly.
I think there were different degrees of study of that over the years, but there was not a comprehensive look.
That's
before
a good
we
point.
Went.
That would be the biggest.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just the upfront sort of look at what should be done, where it can be done, and what the impacts are, what the choices are, and then be able to make a better choice. But the process, I think that there were enough professionals on that committee that everyone who could step in when they needed to step in.
Yeah.
So in my mind, I think it functioned pretty well. It might not have been as streamlined because there were a lot of people at one point having a lot of decisions.
Once you guys were formed, the project was already underway.
It right. was.
Yeah.
And so, you're already down a path.
Yeah.
Yep. Well, that, I think, was the biggest problem
ship
in that
sail.
Project.
Yeah, that was going to be my observation, is that, once the Library Building Committee had been formed, I think there were some some very qualified and capable people on it. But at that point, we were already, by nature of the grant award, as well as some of the other, you know, the conceptual design that we got that grant application, we were already down a path of, here's what you're going to do, and there was no option or recourse for doing anything other than that. I think if there had been a building committee on the front end of that effort, then a lot more investigation and evaluation and research would have been done as to pros, cons, condition of the building, pre-existing conditions, existing conditions you could have identified through more borings, the ledge in the back parking lot. And again, the stockpile and archiving of valuable information relative to building assets or town assets, the corporate knowledge that the basement always leaked water when it rained. I didn't know that. I don't know, Nancy, if you knew that.
I had heard about all the moisture problems down there.
And apparently there was a report somewhere in the town archives that says the basement leaked like a sieve, yet when they designed the building, they didn't incorporate any foundation waterproofing, positive side waterproofing. That would have been an easy one to have incorporated in the design from the get-go and not cost us any money, or any extra money, I should say. So those are the kinds of things that I think if you had the front-end horsepower, like I think the PVC brings to bear now, and not to say any project's ever perfect and that you catch everything and that you're not going to have, there's no guarantee that you're not going to encounter issues down the road, but I think a lot of what the library experienced, I would like to think we could have averted.
Is there a way without the corporate knowledge, though, to note, to ask the questions? It strikes me that anytime you say, gee, we knew this and one hand didn't understand it, the other one did, that may be true, but that's probably not the best way to pass messages on to the next generation. Is there a process issue where we could have discovered that through in the assessment phase, saying, you know what, let's go evaluate the foundation or the footing or the waterproofing? Is that one of the steps you might do on a renovation by default going forward, that in the design phase, one of the first things you do is go evaluate the structural integrity and waterproofing?
I think there are a couple of different answers to the question. One is good record keeping. In terms of archiving existing information, that apparently was in a town report from some time.
I'm saying in the absence of that. That's always good and positive if you have
it. So in the absence of that, for instance, the stakeholder interviews, if you ask the librarians, like, what it is about your work environment that you like, that you don't like, what is it about the building, how many of them would have said, well, the basement's always damp, it's soaking wet when it rains. Well, seems like we might have an ingress problem.
Yeah, but you also got to involve the facilities department. They know most of that stuff. They weren't asked.
Well, they're mitigating that problem when it surfaces.
So they get back to not worried about records. It's nice if they're there, but let's ask the folks that are living and breathing what's going on.
Absolutely.
Well, it seems like that's a process that you guys would undertake, you know, if you were there in the front end. Is it safe to say that the fits and starts of how much the project, you know, two debt exclusion votes and all that, do you think that would have been washed away in the front?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. I mean,
I have no doubt.
And when all was said and done, there was a third move, you know, from the debt side, just rearranging some debt because we still weren't there.
Well, the third move in some respects is unavoidable, only in the sense that there were certain unforeseen and the extent of unforeseen conditions that to some degree drove the budget beyond its construction contingency. In an ideal world, though, a lot of the unforeseen conditions could have been seen if you just knew where to look for them or had thought through enough and not kind of been
willfully blind
in a hurry to put a shovel in the ground as to not lose a grant opportunity.
Well, it sounds like it's a process. I mean, you know, the permanent building committee would have a process that wouldn't let that run off the rails too early. I mean, it would. At least that's the way I have a sense of from what I'm hearing you and Nancy say, that, you know, the work in front never got a chance to happen in that project. Not that I'm trying to tear that project apart, but we're trying to think about the future, you know, and what's the right thing. So.
Well, and I think that, you know, the benefit of having both Nancy and myself on the permanent building committee is we were involved in the library process once the library building committee was formed. So I think we have the lessons learned, personal experience from that process, as well as just, not just myself, but the rest of the members of the committee, that we have the real-world construction experience, either from the design side or the construction management side, of things that you will encounter, or the things that have burned us in the past, the practical lessons learned from the industry itself.
So to that point, would there, Greg, would you see the permanent building committee ultimately building a manual that says, for future, you know, members, this is what we do?
I think the flow chart that we put together is a first step towards that.
Yeah, the thing we saw when you visited us before.
That was very good.
And I'm not sure if a manual is the, and that's still, to me, that's a draft. You know, we still had, there were some concepts and ideas on there that we hadn't finalized. But I think that's as far as we need to get right now to,
right.
And I think what will end up happening is, and we've learned a little bit of this through the cemetery process, which has informed much of this to date, is we'll go through a process and we'll learn what worked and what didn't. And then this will get tweaked slightly so that the next time we go through, it's like the Kaizen, you know, learn through repetition.
Continuous improvement.
Right. And the interesting thing about construction in general is every building is custom. Right, there's no, you don't ever build the same thing twice. There's no identical buildings. But the process, as you identify and discover things, you can implement and incorporate so that you don't miss them the next time. And I think that, you know, you'll see a couple times in that flow chart about archiving information. I think that's critical for whenever it is in the future that, you know, the seven members here turn over and you've got seven different faces, that they all have the same access to the, you know, the same types of information that either we stockpile or archive, or that we wished had been available. For instance, the, you know, the report that said that the library basement leaked like a sieve.
Yeah.
You know, we don't want those sorts of things to get lost again, so that you can't take full advantage of having, you know, somebody having experienced it once before.
Can I do a quick go back? If I were to ask the permanent building committee what it thought its role would be in kind of a, after construction started, what would your natural reaction have been?
I would say that just general characterization, it would be more engaged than it was for the library, but not to the extent that we could provide any sort of full-time or what we envision or what we understand the word management to mean. And I can tell you, just in anybody sitting behind me can chime in if they want to, that the word manage projects
means own projects.
Really just that was one of the big things that jumped out at us and said we
can't do it.
Nighttime volunteer manage implies a certain amount of responsibility that we don't have the time or capacity for.
Yeah. Is oversight a better word?
Yes.
Oversight.
And that's why this is titled oversight, assessment and oversight, as opposed to management.
Craig, I don't remember, but by the time you guys stepped in, was the project manager hired and the architect hired?
The library building committee.
The project manager had been hired. We stepped in, and then we were involved in vetting the architects.
Okay. So, but going forward on a project, you would be involved in that in a much earlier.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah, before even the project.
Oh, yeah.
To be able to kind of see the personnel who might work well, you know, what they bring to the project. Because, mm-hmm. I mean, that's a big piece of it is, you know, who is it, you know, who's really building the building? It's the architect, it's the contractor, obviously we're the owners, but, you know, having those people, interviewing those people is a big piece of ultimately what that final project's going
to
look like.
Well, I didn't have anything to do with the high school at all, but I think Bob could probably speak to, and maybe Joe, is, you know, the competence and quality of the OPM can make a dramatic difference. By law, you're required to, projects over a certain value, hire an OPM. But if you don't get the right one, or if that person sees themselves as just a contractual obligation based on the law, without much, you know, without much purpose, then you got the wrong guy. So I think, to the extent that either we got lucky or did a very good job of hiring the OPM for the library, I think that particular OPM did an excellent job for us.
We should put him on retainer for the
We tried.
Yes, Dan.
Greg and committee, what do you see your role as being for actually selection of the contractor who's going to, the general contractor like the TLT? Would you want to weigh in on the choice that the sponsoring board is going to make?
Thank you, Tim.
Yeah, because when they change the laws, every project over $10 million requires pre-qualification. So if you're to build the high school today, there will be a process where all the general contractors would submit a pre-qualification and be selected on quality, on qualifications, and then allowed to bid on the project. You can do that on all projects, so you know we would want to weigh in on that. We want to be part of that process in conjunction with the architect and the OPM. And we'd have the chance to whittle that down. If you look back on the high school, you had three bidders on the high school, and the number two bidder was out of business about 2 years later. So yeah. That was a very challenging time period. There's a lot more options in the marketplace today, but we'd definitely be involved with sort of the culling down of the general contractors that have been on the project.
If there's no pre-qualification requirement, if it's under $10 million, would you still be involved?
Yeah, we can do pre-qualification. The law says that over $10 million, you have to, but below $10 million, we have the option to. So the
sponsor can require it.
Yeah, we can just the municipality can require pre-qualification on any project.
What levers do you have in pre-qualification? What are being considered?
It's pretty strictly defined. The statute is very strict with, you get 50 points for management. There's like 25 points for capacity to complete project. So it's pretty well defined, and DCAM has pretty well defined scoring and forms and things like that. But you can tweak that, and you can set the metrics what you want to see. For example, with the library, and the library did go through pre-qualification, but you could, if the municipality was very concerned about contractors that had a demonstrated experience in historic building, you can make that a requirement to sort of weed out the, not weed out, but call down to the contractors that that you feel are qualified. You have the ability to, to be as wide or as specific as you want.
Yeah. Does that include things like, on their side, their payment history to their vendors or their financial performance?
There's a requirement to submit your financial statements. Typically, it's your financial statements and revenue under contract that you submit, as well as credit references. Yes, so that's all that's in there. And you always have the, as a municipality, when you're evaluating a contractor or really any vendor, you have the ability to go outside of what they submit. You can go find any information anywhere, and you're allowed to use that information.
Really?
So you don't just have to rely on what they submit.
Now, isn't there a database of, for lack of a better word, kind of like a Better Business Bureau, but a database that the state has of folks who've commented on contractors' performances?
There is. Every contractor that bids on work in Massachusetts is DCAM certified. So they have a DCAM certification. There's a file as a matter of practice. Before the town, I wasn't involved in the library, but before the town hired Delphi was the contractor, the owner's project manager probably went down and reviewed their file. So they have evaluations from every project. So you can see, the past evaluations from like the past 5 years worth of projects.
And those aren't submitted by the person wanted putting in the contract.
The library, if it hasn't been done yet, the owner's project manager will probably prepare that evaluation for the contractor that did the work on the library, but the town, Bob, will probably, I think you're required to sign it.
Yeah, we prepared an interim one, but I don't think it was formal. We just shared it with them informally.
Yeah, that
said, the last one is the only formal one we'll do.
Yeah, the there's a 50% and then 100%,
right.
And the 50% are kind of used sporadically.
Yeah.
So there's an ability to select the contractor to a certain degree, at least select the contractors that bid on the project.
So just in the interest of managing the time tonight, I think one of our, I mean, this has been a great discussion. Isn't part of our primary focus to understand exactly what the changes will be to the bylaw? Was the building committee going to present that? Are you going to just review, have you reviewed those already?
It's up to them how they want to do it. I know they met, the chair met last week with the bylaw committee.
Yeah.
I think I just presented some of the intentions, but then there's naturally some of the language. And I did share with the selectmen in their packet the last draft you guys reviewed. I assume you're still going to work on it.
Yeah, so what I can do is I'll run through just very briefly the kind of the highlights of
yep.
the things that we saw in there that we, without going line by line.
Great.
This was an iterative process where we took the original bylaw language and over the course of a couple meetings, changed verbiage, moved verbiage around, reorganized a little bit. And then what was left over after that, we sent to the bylaw committee. Understanding that there's going to be additional meetings, additional discussions and revisions, but the gist of what we wanted to accomplish in terms of revisions to the bylaw, for the most part, are summarized like this. We wanted to clarify associate memberships. We wanted to clarify the PVC level of involvement during a project, the administer versus manage language that we've talked about already. Clarify the conditions requiring PVC involvement so that projects construction of 1.5 million or more. Define the sponsoring agencies. The word sponsoring agency was used in the bylaw, but it didn't say who they were, it just said sponsoring agency. We wanted to establish the application process. So in the revised language, there's reference to an application. We didn't want to necessarily attach it or include it or
yet to be determined.
Right.
Correct.
Application, right.
Establish when a project formally exists for the purposes of assigning temporary members.
It exists means what in that definition in your mind?
When a project is a project, I think it's town meeting approves a project.
Okay. And that's a nice milestone.
Meaning the least designed.
Correct.
Okay.
So I think roughly the process goes like this. One of the three sponsoring agencies has a proposed project. They tell us, we go through the application process. It's not the intent that if you don't have it filled out 100% accurately and if we sit in the blind and review it, we're more than willing to help you go through it. It will help vet out information that's valuable to us for the evaluation process. Evaluate the project, stakeholder interviews, review data. If we have a consultant that we can do some exploratory work. Some studies, et cetera.
That's where the funding comes in.
And then at some point have what we think is a proposal to make or a presentation to make to town meeting on behalf of the sponsoring agency with potentially an accompanying amendment that would ask for additional funding for continuation of design and or construction. So that's the process. And then once town meeting says yay, nay, then the project exists, then we'd like to have the temporary members representing stakeholder interests.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, Bob.
I'd just like to ask a question of the permanent building committee. For instance, if you look back at the library project and you imagine it to start today, and let's say there's two options under consideration, rehab the existing building or build a new building somewhere else. At what point do you think associate or temporary members should be added while that's being evaluated? Because you're going to have to go to town meeting and get some pretty serious money if truly you want to evaluate and price out two options. So do you want to add your temporary members then when town meeting says, yeah, here's 200,000, whatever it is, go study those two options? Or do you want to add two members, voting members, when you have a project selected? I just throw that out there as a question because this is one of the things I've been thinking about. It's the same thing. When is there a project?
That's why I'm being so harping on this, because that's exactly the same problem we have with sponsoring agency. It was ambiguous, and this has a chance to be exactly the same problem with a lot more consequence because everyone's going to want to jump in on their own set of
So I guess the observation I would make is, at least my personal interpretation, anybody feel free to jump in if they see otherwise, is that the rationale for establishing the permanent building committee was to have an objective evaluation of proposed projects by professionals in the industry. If you have stakeholders in the process, is the, is that objective? Or do you have interested parties who may have a predetermined notion or a preconceived notion of what the best thing is for the stakeholders already in mind?
Right.
That was my rationale for saying that if you want us to be objective and evaluate just strictly on the facts with the best information we have available and the resources and the expertise, leave us to it.
Can't bring the home fans in.
Well, you could, you can. What I think we're saying is that from an actual member voting versus, it's an open meeting.
Right.
Of course.
We would invite them to come. Obviously, we'd need to hear from them and get their consult.
But from a voting perspective.
But from a voting perspective, I'm not sure you'd want them to be voting on it.
I'm interpreting this to be voting.
And the expectation was never to perform this evaluation in a vacuum.
Correct.
You know, we would want to understand from the user groups, from the stakeholders, from the operators, from fire, safety, police.
Well, you actually talk about that.
Right, we want to understand all aspects of this to make the most objective evaluation. So it's not that we want to exclude the people whose building it's going to be. We just don't want our evaluation to be biased by some preconceived notion or some concept of what the right answer is.
So it's a design as in a singular design is the answer, not two.
That's what it sounds like.
Well, yeah, that's what I wanted. It seems, so we're at town meeting. Your town meeting, typically you're going to be asking for design money for a particular project. Is it, you know, for this building here? This is what we thought you would need, and actually had CAD designs that you're showing the town meeting. Or is that something that really needs to be feathered out after the fact? When they say, yes, we see that there's a need for it, you've shown us that, here's some money, and go, you know, come back to us essentially after you've figured out what that need actually transcends it. And at what point do you want associate members?
So I'm hesitant to answer the question only in the sense that every circumstance and every proposed project may have a different set of potential options.
Right.
Take the cemetery, for instance. There may be more than one cemetery and more than one site within a cemetery that is acceptable. They may be equally advantageous. Mm-hmm. I don't know that we want to be in the position to pick one and say, that's the spot. I think we would want to have a list of them, an evaluation of them, and then if we do have some design services, potentially select one or two of the most advantageous sites, have a conceptual design that is suitable for both of those, and a conceptual estimate, and then make that presentation to town meeting.
Okay, I just wanted to see, you know, at what point you would really want to have the stakeholders kind of coming on board as voting members. You know, if there's going to be a lot of design after town meeting, in other words, it's going to be still going out there and figuring it out, you may not want them at that point either. If now there's some interest that they have, that they're bringing now a vote to the table where you have them. You don't have a kind of in the box, so to speak.
Well, I think when you get to the point of if town meeting, and this is my personal opinion only, if town meeting approves a project that a sponsoring agency has proposed and that we've evaluated, I think at that point you most certainly have a project because you're engaging designers to further design for the purposes of construction.
Correct.
Once you advance to that point, I think the stakeholders absolutely need to have a voting stake in their building.
If I could just elaborate a little bit, there's a little bit of confusion. That money that would be part of the initial study, that pool of money would be used to come up with the different options and ideas.
That's the consultant that's the money
consultant
that you guys
that's the 75,000 years of operating budget.
Annual pool of money to
have multiple ideas, right. We'll need that consultant to be able to hone in on where it should
But when
be.
You leave that process, you have one.
That's right.
Okay. But that is different from the design phase when you ask for money for design.
Correct.
Now, I think what I heard you say is when that happens, you've crossed the threshold that says we have a project.
Correct.
Yeah. Now it's time to bring on, you know, the two members from the sponsoring agent that the sponsoring agency, you know, designates to go in. Dan, I know you've had your hand patiently waiting here.
Jeff, we talked about this briefly during town meeting. There's no explicit language in that bylaw right now that empowers you to do siting recommendations, and I would like to see some of that written in to this thing, you know, this go around on the rewrite. I had a recommendation where you might put it. There's a line that goes, the permanent building committee shall present all such projects to town meeting. You know where that is? It's in that paragraph there.
It's gotta be in here somewhere.
Search on present.
Interesting.
I'm sorry, it's, is that part of what's crossed off there?
It is.
Go back up, above that paragraph we were looking at.
Only two instances that are.
Go back up. It's that one, right there.
Okay, there it is, right there.
Yep. So what I would say after that is, along with citing recommendations for set projects, just to make sure you have the power to do the citing in the bylaw.
Present all such projects.
I do think that's important.
It's clearly implied, and you've stated that that's.
I was just gonna say, in my mind's eye, it's implicit in evaluating a project.
Okay.
But if.
Sure.
That's why I answered you at the end of that town meeting.
So you really don't, you don't feel it needs more language?
I don't know, I don't think anybody would ever contest it.
For the sake of four words, it was a confusion.
What if the sponsoring board really wants to kind of take that back out to them? I mean, there should be a designation where the buck stops.
Hey, we just spent an hour arguing over whether we should have legal settlements and an adjustment, so.
That decision will have been made. They can put their two cents in, I mean.
Well, I'll let you practitioners sort that out, that's just a thought, yeah.
More for the sake of more is, I agree, not a good thing to do. However, given the history of our town meeting, you know, we have a town meeting that is very specific about language.
Right.
They're very specific about language.
To be fair, this frame of understanding we have is not gonna be the same in a year, so these are breadcrumbs for folks that come after us.
I agree with you, Greg. To me, it's implicit that citing is part of the process. So to Dan's point, a small handful of words that articulates that may save us an hour and a half of debate in town meeting. I'm just saying, and I don't mean that in any disrespectful way. People are, you know, words do matter. And so I think that if you add a small handful of words that creates what to you or I might seem implicit, may honestly save us an hour's worth of harangue,
Greg, in a similar vein, do you think it's worth distinguishing between what I'll call design money, which is in the assessment phase, versus, I'll call it, these may not be the right words, but we need some words, discovery money or identification money, which is spent after design starts, in that there's either confusion about the intent of the money or the purpose by which and the manner in which and the amount of which is assigned. Do you think there's any value in clarifying those two?
Well, I think the principal clarification may be in where the money is within the budget. If it's within, if it's within Joe's budget annually for the purposes of,
it's the assessment dollars,
right?
Okay,
that would be differentiated from, from design and or construction money approved.
Right. I'm asking this more from a language perspective for the same reasons. Is this a helpful way to convey to folks where these two pools of money exist? We roll this out that this is purely to get the design right. Then you have a live project. Now you have additional conditions you need to go discover. And we want language that clarifies the intent of that in the bylaw or not.
And that you need.
That'll be in the project financing now. You'll have contingencies. You'll have.
I'm just talking about the process document that tells town meeting what they're authorized to do.
Yes, Bob.
You might run into a circumstance, not usually, but in an unusual way, that you really need to do much more investigation between two options.
Yeah.
And the money in the annual budget will not solve that.
Mm-hmm.
And you really need to price out what two options are because they're so different and complex.
And it's a go-do later.
And that's
on.
Still a discovery, well, not in your words, that's still the exploration part.
Right.
But it may have gone back to town meeting and got their approval from, yes, we need more inquiry money here. And it, you know, it could be $500,000. I mean, there are projects that you spend a lot of money up front to figure out some tough questions. So I think this process allows for that. It's just you have to know when does the clock start on a project. And it doesn't start when you're still evaluating options. You may want something to happen, but you still don't know what or where.
But also, too, when you go to town, when we go to town meeting to say, okay, we're gonna rebuild the Killam School, you know, making something up. You're not only gonna have here's what the project's going to look like, we're also going to have a financing piece to it too. So we're going to have to already have figured out how much are we, you know, is this going to be a debt exclusion? Is this going to be within the levy? Is this going to be, you know, we have to have basically a financing mechanism in place as well. So, you know, when you're voting on a project, that's what you're voting on. It's not just what it's going to look like, but how we're also going to finance it. So,
but you know, we know this town, this option really doesn't exist easily. But if you realize Killam needs to be rebuilt, maybe you want to build it somewhere else. And you might need to really price out the two options more than they would normally do with their $75,000. So that's still part of the learning curve before there is a project that everyone agrees that's the project. So I think, you know, they've thought of those things, and that's why some of the language is not as specific, saying here's when the whistle blows.
When do we have some idea that we're going to be able to? So
this has to go in by the end of February if it's going to be.
Yeah, I just don't want the clock to tick away on us is the reason I'm bringing this up, because there's a couple of little nuances here, and it seems like you guys have done the hard work. And I am interested to hear from you guys, Jeff, if you think the work so far is going to match up to it being legal. I mean, you guys aren't policy board. You guys are, is it okay board, you know?
Having received it from Greg last week, and you've sure gone over it and went over it with him, we understand their goals.
Yeah.
And that, I think what we really wanted to be understood last week was to be clear on the goals, and I think you've seen that. There's certain nuts and bolts things we have to do. We're looking at this and like, you know, what exactly do you mean by project application? It's not defined anywhere. You know, we sort of, this is the sort of mechanics of putting the bylaw together. I think something that sort of I heard tonight that we might want to consider is putting language in there about, you know, that they shall, you know, request funding as they seem necessary. You know, if you're asking for money to be held in a, you know, capital plan every year, it might be nice to have at least the authorization to use it in the bylaw. Just a quick thought. There's nothing
well,
in here.
It truncates one more vote. If you do that,
there's nothing
sure.
in here that I think we can't get to where they want it. As far as I can see, we will discuss this later. And there's certain things that I can see town meeting, you know, stumbling over some of this. But you know, that's what town meeting is supposed to do.
Well, it goes with the territory. That part's okay. But
so, Bobby, we're meeting next month, and we'll hopefully by when we do ask for the latest version of what this is. You guys meeting before now?
No, January 5th, or maybe, no, it's the 2nd is Monday, so it's the 9th.
So let's just be real attentive to our deadline, Bob, for April. I do think it's really a good idea for us to get a working bylaw that you guys are, you know, that you guys are comfortable with as quickly as we can. And April seems like the time, but, you know, as we all know in town government, you back up 2 months before that. Yes, Jeff?
Yeah, I do have a question. Most of the organizational slides you put up there, that's all more or less internal. It's not something you actually want to codify, is that correct?
You mean the PowerPoint slides?
Right.
That
well, how are you going to do it? My point is, that should be your decision, and it should be fluid.
Correct. Yes.
So you don't want to put that right down in stone.
That's a policy of the committee.
Right.
Yeah. But also, one of the things I want to say in here is that you shall make that policy known to the people you want to, the itemized board you want to put in there,
right.
Sponsoring agencies in the previous week. Just make sure that you know, it'll be your duty to let them know what it is.
Mm-hmm. You need to codify that though, or you are going
to
should
just
codify?
Just to the point of saying that they shall develop. We were talking about this last week. They shall develop the project application process and shall let the 1, 2, 3.
That then becomes not something you're trying to codify. That's
right.
A policy of.
I would recommend against codifying.
Yeah,
shall.
I think what Jeff's saying is just to make the language clear to the sponsoring agencies that we have an internal process and that we have to make you and library and school committee aware of that process, just so that, you know, they don't get blindsided by it. Or
yep.
Right.
We don't refuse to look at something simply because you didn't follow our process, which you knew nothing about.
Are we missing anything for tonight's meeting that needs to?
I don't think so.
Anything from either of the two committees present that you'd like to? We good for now?
I did offer to Gene Borowski over the weekend that since they had scheduled a meeting for tonight, that I'd come to one of their meetings between now and the end of January to update them on what happened, but I think they're going to be satisfied.
Next steps, what are the next steps?
These guys have to meet.
Meet on the 9th.
Yep.
Well, the permanent building committee has a regular monthly meeting scheduled for the 9th already. Jeff, with you guys, if you get far enough along in a draft, or if you're comfortable that you want to meet with the group of us, or have a product that you want to send our way, then we can be flexible.
Well, I have one scheduled for the 11th. That's going to change. I can guarantee it.
Okay.
The only thing I think we need to take from this that you gave is essentially could give you a list of suggestions for that. This isn't going to change.
Well, we didn't necessarily wordsmith it to the point of it being ready for. We just wanted to get the language that we were sensitive to revised to the extent that it said what we wanted it to say, and then.
This is a macro discussion.
Correct.
Yeah.
You know, for clearly, and I think that's. I mean, we've talked about a lot of things, but it seems like fundamentally, we're hearing what you're interested in, and that all makes sense. You've gotten a couple of suggestions. It sounds like from a code standpoint, you know the direction this is going.
Yeah, we want to give them as much of what they want, and still keep them somewhat fluid so they can make decisions later.
So, yes, Bob.
Yeah, in general, they trying to determine the policy. They help with the language, and then that all has to go to town council for review before you see it.
So again, I'm going
to
just be a
pain in
the neck about this
time-wise.
Yeah.
No, it doesn't have to be wrapped up in January 9th.
When's the warrant closed?
No, but they're 9. You guys are 11. I'm not sure if that works. And then when's the warrant?
They can see it again in their first meeting in February. I forget the date. But that means town council has to already seen it and approved it. You guys just are having a last look at it.
So it seems like the 23rd or something like that. Why is that in my head?
That's about right. February,
I think the 23rd
like that.
Is the. So we got to, I mean, I'm just saying to both committees, try to arrange your time and your posting so that we can get it into town council's hands so that there's ample time that in the February meetings, you're both kind of good to go. So when it finds its way here, so we can close the warrant. We know where you are. We know where where the bylaw committee is, and we can lock that into the town meeting so that it can sit there and perk for 2 months, waiting its turn, in April. Are we good?
I think so. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks to both of you.
Thank you.
You guys.
Thanks for your continued service.
Yeah.
You guys got to close your meeting.
Second.
Good.
Okay, you guys are all closed up. Okay. Records officer.
That's Matt. Back there somewhere.
Okay, Mr. Records officer. You're on. Thanks again.
Thank you, guys. So people know that the public records law is changing as of January 1st.
Oh, the simplified plan.
What's that?
Is this part of the simplified plan?
Yes.
That's right.
This is actually very simple.
Municipal modernization.
Yeah. So we have to appoint RAOs, which is record access officers. And they're just the people that coordinate the records. They make sure they're accurate. They get them to people, make sure the time frame is in order. And so I met with the chief, the town clerk is here as well. We came up with a list of people that would make sense. And I think, do you have my memo?
Yep. Yeah, it was in the packet.
Okay.
Yeah.
So now if you have the memo, I have the names of the people. One of them is me. Okay. Yeah, one of them would be obviously the town clerk who's here tonight. Me, the deputy police chief, David Clark.
Yeah, not clerk.
Oh, David Clark. David, he could be a clerk. The lieutenant detective, Richard Abardi, superintendent of schools, John Doherty, and the special ed person, Carolyn Wilson. So we're just here to ask that you actually appoint those people tonight. And you have the authority to do that according to town council.
Chairman?
Yes.
You were first.
Matt, notwithstanding the appointment of names, the process that will be used here, I had a chance to chat with chair of the school committee, and they have obviously similar responsibilities. Their primary concern is how do you manage to scrub personally identifiable information?
Right.
Mm-hmm. I assume we have somewhat similar, maybe less instance of it, but still the same concerns. What's the process to get to do that?
Yeah, well, that's part of what the records access officers do, is they'll look to see things that are typically a public record, things that could be exempted. They'll work with me. I work with town council.
But how? Is it in a machine somewhere where those fields are excised before it's printed? Is it an annual scan?
Well, it depends on whatever the record is. You know, it could be, if it's electronic records, we could do it that way. If it's paper records, they could be blacked out and redacted.
What I hear you saying is that most cases it'll be a read and
it's, yeah,
judgment.
There's no automatic for that. Plus, you're applying the statute, so you're applying the exemptions, you know. So, you know, it may be a lot of things that might need to be.
So a fair amount of training here, judgment.
There's going to be some training involved.
Okay. Thank you.
Chairman?
Yes, Dan.
Matt, will these folks be able to delegate further if they need to?
Well, they hopefully they're going to be really the main people that do the work, like especially talk to the police chief, and those are the people that do it now.
Mm-hmm.
If we need assistance gathering records, I think the statute says that you have to designate the lowest paid person, qualified person to do that, and I think they cap the rate at like $25 an hour or something.
Oh.
So there could be some clerical assistance that actually gathers the record, but then it goes to the records access person, and they look at it, and we'll look at it and decide whether it should be released. And most of the times it is released, but like you said, personally identified information, other exceptions, personnel records, certain police records.
And the schools have vetted these two names in their hands?
Yes, actually I got these two names from John Doherty himself. And he thought it made sense for him to be there and also one other person, because I guess they deal with special ed records.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
What's the penalty for failure to scrub?
Failure to scrub the record? So if you
personally identifiable information is disclosed, what's
right.
the penalty?
You could be sued.
You could be sued, yeah. You don't want to go down that road, so we want to make sure. I mean, that's the same in the... That didn't really change with the new law. We now look at that information, too, and we withhold that if it meets the exception. The definition of the public record really didn't change. It's sort of the mechanics around it, the time to comply, and the penalties, you know, if you don't comply.
Matt, I noticed that there's two members of the police department, but nobody from the fire department. Is that
Is there
a reason why we're not?
The
fire records aren't.
I don't think they deal with it. A lot of their records are exempted through HIPAA anyway. If it's like
medical
records,
so
they didn't see that as something they needed. But you know, here at town hall, it'll be me and the town clerk, and we'll always, if there is a question that comes up, we can always handle it for any town department.
Well, for example, sometimes I know when you're doing a commercial real estate loan,
right,
you do a 21E,
mm-hmm.
and sometimes 21E is going to the public record, a lot of which are held by the fire department.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, that's true.
So you want to go back and see, for example, you know, this person wants to build something on there, it was once a gas station,
mm-hmm.
right? So the lender's going to require, mm-hmm. you know, a record search, and some of that's held at the fire department.
Right.
So
I mean, we can always add, if we feel a need, and that's coming up a lot, we could add more records coordinators. There has to be at least one. So we have that, and we'll have five now, five or six. So if we need somebody if that comes up to the fire department, I'll come back to you and ask for another name to be appointed. But we think right now we can handle it with the current names we have.
But I mean, people can still access that information.
Oh, sure, yeah. Oh, no,
they're
going to still request it. It's really on our end, you know, how we deal with it.
Okay.
So, right.
Once we appoint this group that you've recommended,
right?
Is there any magic to the number? If you needed somebody from the fire department, we could act on.
Yep.
So in other words,
right,
you get a request and you make a decision, for example,
right,
that you really need somebody, you know,
at the fire department.
Greg, you know, somebody from Greg's office needs to be included.
Sure.
It sounds like it's as simple as appointing someone from here, just like we're going
to
do.
It is, yeah. I would come back to you and ask to add that name to the
list.
Yeah,
no magic to the number.
All right,
you know.
No magic, as long as you have at least one, you know.
Yeah. Okay.
John?
Some towns may just have one.
Yes, John.
How long is that appointment good for? Is it life?
Until canceled.
Okay.
So, I mean, and your essentially what's happening in the motion that's on its way to get in front of you.
Right.
Is that you're appointing a position and naming a person.
Yep.
Now, that person could be different.
Right. It's more the position, but the name.
The position you're naming.
Yeah.
Right. Yep, that's why I've included the names.
And we did ask the light department, with the default being Matt and the town clerk, and they haven't answered, so that's the default. They may come to us in the future and say, well, no, we want.
And the default decision on the question about the fire is, you didn't see a need at this time for that, but.
Right, if we do.
Obviously, you're gonna reserve the right to come to us with any of those things that need to be altered.
Yeah, right now, I don't think we have a lot of requests like that, but if we find that we do, we would come back to you. And ask for additional, same with light department if they decide they want somebody.
So if the person no longer holds the position by which we just voted for, and a new position comes in, do we have to revote that person, or are we voting?
I suggest your motion not include the names.
Okay.
That's for your information.
Yeah, all right, so that was my question.
So, the parenthetical just lets us know who that person is at this time.
Right.
So we're really voting the position.
You're voting the position. The names are in there, so you know who's currently holding those positions.
All right.
So
more questions from anybody?
Ready to go.
All right, move that the Board of Selectmen appoint the following employees as records access officers. Town clerk, director of administrative services, deputy police chief, lieutenant detective, superintendent of schools, school department special education.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Matt.
Thank you.
Did we actually make a motion on the TLT litigation?
No, you never did, I don't.
The interim.
I think we took a vote.
Yes, we did.
Okay. But did we make a motion on it? Okay.
Was there a motion?
Barry read the motion, Dan seconded it.
Yeah, remember that.
You're talking about.
Did we take the vote?
Yes, 5-0.
I wasn't as noteworthy as I thought.
Okay, come on, everybody, catch up.
Okay. Please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Reading will hold a public hearing on December 13, 2016 at 8:30 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., on a driveway variance request for 154-156 Green Street. Copy of the proposed document regarding the topic is available. Town Manager's Office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Monday, Wednesday, Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesday from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and it's attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on December 13, 2016 to Town Manager at ci.reading.ma.us by order of Robert W. Lasher, Town Manager.
Thank you. First, I'll introduce our town engineer. I don't think he's been formally in front of you, Ryan Percival.
Hey, Ryan.
Hey, Ryan.
I think you have.
He's
ready for prime time. He's all set.
By the way, your rookie season's only 1 year. So
yeah, that's what they say.
And the honeymoon's probably over, so.
It will be tonight.
Into the water tower.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, the
that's
cell right. tower. So here you go.
The first
one's Green Street.
All yours.
They're so easy to see.
Yeah, so I gotta say you can maximize.
As with all these driveway variances that we propose, is engineering reviews them and whether they adhere to the driveway policy set forth by the Board of Selectmen, they're approved or they're not approved, and then there's an avenue for the applicant to request a variance, and that's through PTTF, Parking Transportation, whatever the task force.
Yeah.
Didn't have another T.
Where we review it again, and from there we generate either a recommendation or not to recommend it, but it still comes forth to the Board of Selectmen. What we have here on Green Street, I'll just go to the proposed. It's a unique situation in the sense that it does not fit the policy for the Board of Selectmen for driveways. However, it's a condominium. Mm-hmm. There's two condos.
It's two separate entities.
So they're essentially two separate single-family dwellings.
Mm-hmm. With one structure.
We run into this occasionally. We don't run into it all the time. But in this instance, there's a. Now point to it on here.
Right up and point.
You can't really see the mouse, but there's a utility pole in this general area where there's a grass strip.
Mm-hmm.
The hardship is that to move a utility pole is pretty costly.
The other hardship is that they're two separate entities and they have two separate
entrances.
They have two separate garages. So
the parking's deeded for each condo, correct?
Correct. So what's put forth tonight is two separate entrances. They do not meet the 125-foot separation. They are 18 feet in width, so they're not the full 24 feet wide for each entrance. And when this went in front of PTTF, it was seemed reasonable to generate this recommendation to say that with the utility pole being the two separate condominium, two separate garages, the fact that there's also large driveways in that area, it's not out of place. So the recommendation from PTTF was to allow this.
Mm-hmm. And this would be one curb cut or two with a little?
No, this would be two separate curb cuts with that grass strip separating where the utility pole is. Okay. And there's also a grass strip or wall, depending on what they do in the future, to separate the two driveways on their property. So they do flare out a little bit, but they do narrow down at the right of way, which is where the curb cut begins.
Okay. Yeah, it's strange that we don't have it as a our policy for something like this.
So
to
this was
to even trigger all the way
up
to
us. This was discussed to bring forth whether or not we actually should have it in the policy, but I think this doesn't happen so often.
So unusual.
It's
yeah,
better to
it
have
is
it vetted through PTTF and then bring forth as a variance.
Is there a similar property on Washington Street, like literally a block away? I think they tore down an old home on the memory service north side of Washington. It's like 160 Washington. And there's a duplex there with two driveways out front.
Or maybe.
I don't recall.
Yeah,
why was that not brought to us as a variance?
It depends on whether or not the applicant wants to.
Somebody knows the answer.
Tony DeRozzo, 130 John Street.
Mm-hmm.
The property you're referring to actually only has one driveway.
Oh, it does. Okay.
Yeah. It also depends on whether or not they want to put forth and ask for two separate driveways. In this instance, they can't.
So if it wasn't for the pole, they could have just did one driveway and they would have been fine.
They could have at 24 feet wide and flared it out.
Right, okay.
Okay. This is pretty cut and dried.
Yeah.
It's really about the pole.
Yeah.
It essentially becomes part of about the pole. You're right.
A lot of money. It sounds like that would be a lot of money to do it.
It's not cheap to move a pole depending on what's on it.
So effectively what you have is 36 feet of driveway instead of 24 feet of driveway because you're accommodating
two times 24.
Essentially.
Yeah.
But if you want to perceive
yes.
If you want to perceive it correctly, take into account that 5-foot strip separating the two and that's essentially how big your opening will feel and look in the neighborhood.
But there's some accommodation of the 18 to the maximum 24. You kind of feel it's already been reduced.
Well, I think the key
is it can be reduced.
Separate ownership too, right?
I mean, it could always be reduced smaller.
I think that's the key.
I think at that point, though, because of the width, the distance between the property line and the driveway, there's not much maneuverability. So the 18 seemed reasonable. They didn't go for the full 24 for each, but.
I mean, it does seem to me, I mean, if we agreed that these could be two individually owned condominiums that could be sold as single family residences, and that's cleared everything to this point, you know, they've got a driveway space.
Yeah.
They need to be empowered to use it. It seems like that probably should have been thought about when the whole, the whole development happened, but here we are, so.
This is a no-brainer in my book. We had just.
Dan?
Public comment.
Is there public comment on this? Yes.
Tony DeRozzo, 130 John Street.
Yes.
Is it my impression that the Board of Selectmen believe that because this is a duplex, the applicant would actually get 224 driveways?
I don't know that I have any opinion on that. I'm trying to, from a common sense standpoint, think about two single family residences. There'd be two driveways. Driveways tend to be 24 feet. This is not a request for that. I'm not sure the point of your question.
My concern is that I don't want the board belaboring under an incorrect assumption that a multi-family plot of land would get X number of driveways per residence.
Right, we understand.
Yeah, we do understand that, and there isn't.
Even though there's a duplex, you would only get one 24-foot driveway under normal conditions.
Correct. Right, got it.
One that doesn't have a utility pole.
Well, even with the utility pole, you'd get 24 feet with it. Where you put it is your choice, but.
Other public comment?
Move to close the hearing on the driveway variance 154-156 Green Street.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Move that the Board of Selectmen allow two adjacent driveway openings, each 18 feet in width, separate by a small grass plot at 154-156 Green Street.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Okay.
A little early for the next one? 2 minutes?
Yeah. Mayor, what?
Can we do some minutes?
No, we got
another driveway.
We have another driveway.
Do we have to wait till 8:45, though?
Yes.
You do, as opposed to here.
How do we get sooner?
You can start later, you can start earlier.
Right. How do we go to the minutes?
Well, let's do some minutes.
Yes, minutes.
Okay.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of November 29th, 2016 as amended.
Second.
Any discussion?
I have nothing.
I actually don't.
Everybody's good?
That's going to take all of 1 minute.
All those in favor? Opposed? Minutes approved?
Minutes approved.
I think those are the only minutes we had. Okay, we're going to take, we're going to recess till.
Do we need to, can we move on to the?
You can?
Yeah, the licenses at the end.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's say that.
A past board just delegated that to the town manager. This is not something you need to approve individual license for, you just have to approve that the town manager will issue those licenses as in the past.
So moved.
You don't even need a motion, I just need to tell you that.
Is there a second?
The process is ongoing.
This is a heads up.
Yeah, it's a heads up. You can make a motion.
We don't even need to make a motion.
No harm in that.
Yep.
He did, so that's fine.
To delegate to the town manager the approval of non-alcohol licenses and special permits for early opening.
Okay.
I do want to just comment if I might.
We have a second.
That is also part of Ray's assignment to come back to you with. Well, alcohol was first priority, but your other licenses, he's looking at it. Matt is helping him.
Got it.
Okay.
So any discussion on the motion?
I second it.
We have a second for that motion. All those in favor? Opposed? Okay.
Now we'll take a 7 minute break.
We're gonna.
Hey, we're efficient though.
Reconvene at 8:45.
The puppy's fast.
what you're looking at here is an as-built for a detached accessory apartment.
Okay.
That was approved by ZBA. Initially, September 26th of this year, they brought forth a plan for an approved 24-foot wide driveway.
By 24, you mean the curb cut only. We're not talking
correct.
About any
and
dimension
that,
inside.
Because of that, because this is a cul-de-sac, it's measured on the curve.
So it's the arc distance.
Correct.
Not, okay.
Not the cord length. That being said, when it was time for sign-off for occupancy, the as-built set forth showed a driveway opening greater than 24 feet at 32 feet. At this time, engineering could not sign off. It was a didn't adhere to Board of Selectmen policy. So we did not sign off. What we did do was brought this in front of the PTTF for review upon request of the applicant. They were having some issues at the time with their contractor. So PTTF heard the case and discussed all issues with this driveway. Being that there are two separate buildings, they're merging into a driveway that's very tight. And also with the issues that they have with the contractor and there's people inhabiting this dwelling already, the PTTF came to a decision that they would recommend that this be reviewed by the Board of Selectmen and to...
So the new structure is occupied?
Correct.
The new structure is the one that's in the back?
No, it's
in the front.
It's actually in the front.
Oh.
So they
it's at the driveway. It's down at the driveway.
Correct. Correct.
Ryan, from that drawing or your memory, can you tell us...
Picture next, I can't remember.
Do you have an actual as-built or...
This is the actual as-built.
Oh, okay.
The
next is
sorry,
your photograph.
Which is the primary residence, which is the apartment? Oh, okay. Existing.
So
that's the new one.
Okay.
Oh, that's
the
a
primary
lot.
Residence is up the driveway.
It's up the driveway, yeah.
So was the driveway always that width?
You just go further down, I think there might be a picture.
Yeah, I was trying to zoom out.
There it is. Okay. Yep.
These pictures are a little...
Respective as of, yeah.
Yeah. So the problem is where this driveway for is acting for both. And that's why they made it bigger, and then it triggered the...
Well, from what we understand, there were some constraint issues. There was some contraction, contractor issues, and that's why this driveway is as wide as it is.
What does that mean? There were contract issues. I don't understand what that means.
It's like somebody might know.
I'd like to ask Ryan before I get an answer from the
Well, that's the homeowner under oath.
What's your understanding?
My understanding is that the contractor did not adhere to the plan of what was approved for the 24 feet.
So that's already a 32. So
correct.
This is not permission. This is forgiveness.
Correct.
What's going on today?
Correct.
Or mitigation.
Well, yeah. Yes.
Earlier tonight, John Halsey asked me some questions that Ryan's kind of just alluded to part of it, but I just want to be clear that this is an accessory apartment built under the revised zoning bylaws. In talking to both of our planners tonight, and I had a short discussion previously, this is not necessarily what was imagined when that bylaw was changed.
It's certainly not an apartment.
I did not know, and
it's
shame
it's
on
house.
Me, that a detached structure could be built.
Yeah, that was a little bit of a surprise.
But
yeah.
In talking to them, and they worked with Nancy Toomey, it was always imagined it to be in the rear of a property, not
right.
in the front.
Yeah, that's why I
so
asked.
This had to go in front of ZBA and ask for a special permit. And likewise, ZBA had not anticipated this kind of a twist.
Mm.
But given the language of the bylaw, they did not have an ability to deny it because
yeah.
it didn't say you can't put it in the front yard. So that's food for thought in the future, is if the community wants to allow this in front yards, that's what they've done, perhaps unexpectedly or unintentionally.
What did we just pass?
No,
I thought that changed
it. We just revised it in November. This was passed under the old one.
Right.
Which has 750, I forget, net usable square feet. We've changed that to 1,000 square feet gross. and this would not qualify anymore.
This one looks like
it's too large.
1,500.
But I thought there was language that the front yard wouldn't qualify anymore either. That's not correct?
It's okay, it's okay.
So technically, right now, we still have on the books that the front yard is allowable.
No, we have the absence of location.
Right.
Is what we have.
The absence of location.
We have the absence of location. It's assumed to be on the property.
Yeah, on this property, there were some mitigating factors, ledge and wetlands to consider, that they just couldn't build it in the rear. But I guess my real point is, this is a legal, you know, it went through a legal process. It followed the existing bylaw. And if the community does not want detached structures in front yards,
the
bylaw needs to change.
So what, just as a point of curiosity, what is the square footage of this dwelling?
Do you happen to know what the square footage too?
It's about, I believe, 850 or so. One thing I want to point out, there's a carport on the far side of that.
Could you just identify who you are?
Sorry. Frank Wiggins, 61 Terrace Park.
Okay.
Homeowner. And on the far end of that is a carport, so the roof looks like it's much bigger than it actually is. It definitely conforms to all of the regulations that were laid out. We did have to go to ZBA for approval for a special permit, not for a variance or anything like that, just because that's the way the bylaw was written. But everything conformed. The whole issue with the driveway was that in the field, when the contractor was doing it, I don't know if you can see next to the garage, that's all ledge there,
mm-hmm.
and it follows the driveway, it hugs the driveway. In the field, the contractor realized that the way the plan was drawn out, they would have had to cut into the ledge to make that plan work, which would have been a high cost. So he made a decision on the fly to do it the way he did it. He thought it was 24 feet at the street, and it is 24 feet at the street, but it's not 24 feet at the edge of the property.
Frank, could you repeat that description, but using the diagram from the top?
Sure.
I don't quite understand the ledge comment, so go back to the top view and maybe blow that up, Ryan.
Sure. You want to look at the plan view here?
That's fine. Just yeah. So we kind of, it's tough to see the photograph because it's... So the ledge you talked about is...
This is all ledge right along here. Okay. And originally the plan was to have it come out and cut in. And he would have had it cut into ledge here. And so he made a decision in the field to go around this way, thinking he was still within...
I guess I don't understand that at all, because as you've described it, you could accommodate a 24-foot curb cut by coming inside, not cutting into the ledge at all, but necking it down so that it joined the existing driveway, so that at the point they emerged at that core to the arc, you had 24 feet. So that's why I don't understand the story about the ledge at all.
Yeah, but I think if you see it, though, it's a whole elevation drop from that other driveway. Is that what you're saying? Kind of come up into the other driveway more to meet the 24
no,
feet?
I'm just asking the question about ledge.
Okay.
So if we go over here to the ledge, what I heard was there's pre-existing ledge here hugging this line. The contractor believed that removing that was problematic and so followed the line of the ledge and yielded 32 feet. What I don't understand is why this arc can't simply be sharpened. Achieving the 24 feet avoids the ledge, actually gives you a place to dump snow, so there's some advantage there. That's the part I don't get. How does the ledge compel you to have a larger driveway rather than a smaller driveway?
All I can tell you is what the contractor told me, which is that when the original plan was to have a retaining wall here and have a shorter driveway. That is true.
Retaining wall for what?
There are
topographical issues when they're doing the two merging of the driveway, so a retaining wall would be necessary.
There's a retaining wall here, and there's a bit of a slope going. This goes down about 2 feet from the curb down.
What's the impact of going to 24 feet in the topology now? We don't have a topo map here. So.
I do not. It still would require a retaining wall in the between the two driveways.
I'm trying to understand why, if you make the entrance, because I was there today, I'm trying to understand why having a more narrow to code
entrance,
number one, requires a retaining wall. That actually doesn't make much sense to me. I mean, if you have 8 feet less to the left of that screen, and you come in to a narrower driveway, you will swing around to get into the second stall, and you will back out at an angle to, you know, to do that very thing. I don't
follow the explanation at all.
I mean, the explanation as to why it has to stay that way doesn't make sense to me. I mean, the question certainly needs to be raised, you know, and unfortunately, the contractor is your employee.
Yeah.
Okay? And for him to make a decision in the field to break the zoning codes, I mean, he's got a problem.
Yep.
Because it seems like to me, if it was done correctly, assuming you have a two-car garage because there may be two people living there and they have two cars and they want to put them in there. Yeah, I get that. It makes sense. No problem there. Why does it have to be wider in order to be able to do that?
The explanation he gave was the ability to swing into that second stall based on the way it was originally planned out. I do have the original plan here if you wanted to see that.
I mean, that actually just kind of doesn't make sense to me. I'm not trying to be obstinate with
no,
you.
No, I
just,
understand.
You know, because
I'm very sympathetic. This is a problem you've got, but it's really your contractor's created it for you. What we're struggling with is,
once we start to do this,
there's no end to it.
Yeah. You got to understand the reason that this is a bigger discussion than 8 feet of hot top, which is really what we're talking. When I drove up on it today, I said to myself, "This is already done."
Yes.
I mean, that was just my, you know, my eye looking at it saying, this is not 24 feet.
Right.
You know, this wasn't a request to expand the driveway. This is a request to forgive, you know, something that was done, or, you know, a discussion to mitigate that, one or the other. I think part of the problem we have, and I think one of the things we've learned, for example, you know, the concept of accessory apartment, I think, is a really strong one, and I personally endorse it. I think that as our population changes, the opportunity to do that with parents and children is, you know, something that's important. If we start, and so one of the things we've discovered is you had to put it in your front yard.
Okay.
I don't think that was ever kind of imagined, to be honest with you. But here it is, and it's, you know, and it is beautifully done.
Thank you. It's also sort of in our side yard because our house faces the other way.
Yeah.
Semantics.
Side, front, but you understand what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I mean, when somebody drives up on your property, you know, it just so happens that your home is beautifully situated up in the woods,
right,
and it looks out over something that I couldn't tell because it doesn't look down at the street.
Right.
So when you drive up, the first reaction you have is, here's this beautiful little home.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's kind of the thing you get when you drive up.
Right.
So, okay, I mean, it's there, it's done, it's beautifully done. If we start making accommodations after the fact, I mean, what kind of, I'm just concerned about that. Not to give you a bad time.
No, and
I mean, and your contractor, I think, is where the problem is here.
We create a precedent that we have rules and then people can make them back. Oh, you can go to Selectmen and we'll just take care of it.
Or it's done, we don't want to rock the boat. Is this granite curb or bitumen?
There's no curb, right?
I don't believe so. No.
So what is it?
I'm pretty sure there's no curb.
There's no curb.
It's hot top coming out onto the street.
So what is the practical impact of a judgment we make here tonight over 32 versus 24 then? There's no consequence to
the hot top would need to be removed.
It would be saw cut and removed. They can flare out on their property.
But
of course.
But narrowly on the question of as it enters from that arc into the apron, they can drive over their own grass if they chose to, right?
Sure.
Essentially.
I actually don't think that would be necessary, but yeah, you could. But My wife has done it many times.
Yeah.
Unnecessary. My issue here is the precedent. We've, maybe not in your term, but in my term, we've had a number of people come with what I'll call undocumented 32-foot driveways, and the logic is invariably the same. Didn't know, put it in, been using it for 10 years, or whatever, please forgive. In this case, it's a little different. This is new construction. In the former cases I've seen, it's been discovered after the fact, a priori, and they're trying to turn something that's been used practically for some amount of time. I can go either way on those too, by the way. So, but not without prejudice to this discussion, I think this is different. This is, they were given direction to go to 24 feet, they did not. Now they're back saying, hey, how about 32? And the answer, I'm going right back to what's wrong with the original guidance, and why wouldn't we direct them to go back to that?
So from an engineering or safety standpoint, are there concerns? Did you have concerns when you know?
From a safety standpoint, I would say there's no. You mean to go to a 24-foot wide driveway?
In both cases.
Way. Either way. I mean,
either way.
Essentially, I would say no. I would say no. Again, the original plan was 24 feet, was approved. This, again, we're talking about something that wasn't put in for a plan. So it was designed accordingly to make those swings. I think either way, leaving at 32 or going to 24, there should be no safety concern.
But 24 works, is that what you're saying?
It worked on the previous plan, correct, yes.
It gives them enough leeway to swing in and swing out.
I do have the plan here if you want to see.
Sure.
That
yeah,
like,
yeah, why not?
Yeah, I apologize.
We're not trying to make your life difficult. Just
no.
This is the as-built or
this
as?
This is the original plan that you did not prepare to.
Oh, I see. It's not an arc at all. It's
yeah,
not
this,
an arc at
this
all.
This is coming out this way.
Is this ledge then in here?
This is ledge around here. He actually cut it in a little bit, so the ledge goes right through here, and this driveway comes out.
So you don't have as much land just ready to hot top right here as this plan.
But he has. But he
has. I see. So in other words, he actually made this larger.
He pushed. This is pushed into the ledge. This wall right here.
You can see it here. This is a topo map. So, but you do have enough to create this arc. You do have enough if this is the 24 to arc it like this. I don't want to draw this.
This line would have to stay where it is.
Correct.
And then once you get to here,
you
have
but you
to
can flare
you
that.
You can flare that out anywhere you want.
You can flare that out
isn't
anywhere you want once you're on your property.
Correct.
And isn't this right now, right this corner right here? Put that go right there. My big
what's
figure.
That heavy black one?
That's technically blacktop right now, correct?
That is, yeah.
That
is
definitely blacktop.
This is
so
all blacktop.
It's blacktop
okay.
Up to here.
So then
this is
where he missed is he missed coming out to this point here. He flared too much.
He widened
he
this to this
he didn't
point.
Cut it in enough.
The reason he needed to have this is because he put a retaining wall here.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not shown in the as.
That wall doesn't exist
anymore.
No, but if you look, there's almost an arc coming back towards the retaining wall.
Mm-hmm.
But that retaining wall is,
it follows this arc.
It follows that arc, which is like right through here. So he would have to cut into ledge in order to be able to get into this other driveway.
But
that
this is the as-built. So if we went back to here and we put on this, the 24-foot mark, it would be about here by my arc.
Mm-hmm.
To Kevin's point, you could literally go from here and up. It doesn't change any of this dimension.
That's what I'm trying to get at.
It doesn't change.
How much does it actually change?
It preserves the 24-foot, but gives him relatively complete freedom of the existing
Ryan, how far from how far in onto on this line here? How far in would they have to cut? I mean, at what point are they no longer?
At what point is it not a curb cut but part
are
of
we
the?
We on
part of
3 feet.
You mean from the edge of pavement back to our
from the street?
When is your
back
right
onto
away?
Their property?
When is your right
where
away
where
stop?
Does a town right away stop where they can say no? We can do whatever we want here.
Generally, it's usually about 8 feet ish.
Okay, so it's
in this area here without scaling.
So that's
right,
this.
Right,
that's,
right.
I can't tell you
that's
exactly
this. That's the intent of this line right then was the 8 feet. I'm guessing this line right here.
This right. What you're looking at here is the right of way. This is the edge of pavement.
Oh, so this is the 8 feet.
Oh, so this is
yes.
the. Oh, okay.
So that little piece that you're indicating right there. That's,
oh, okay.
That's
that's.
So that has to be preserved. That 24-foot dimension has to be true anywhere within this region.
Yeah, right.
And
okay.
Then you can flare out.
So from this point here, you can flare up.
Right.
Which it does at the moment.
So that point here, to go back to this drawing.
Go to the street.
Yeah.
That point is here. But that's not 24 feet. That
now,
would have to come
is
over.
Is it unreasonable to think, Ryan, let me just ask you this. Because, look, we're not trying to make your life miserable. We're just trying to get this so that you can use and enjoy your property and we can play by the rules.
Absolutely.
I mean, those are the two things that we need to work on.
Sure.
I mean, if we can accomplish both of those things, play by the rules as agreed, and you have good use of your property, that's the, in my mind, that's the ultimate answer. So the question becomes, I mean, does it
Thank
make some
much.
Sense to continue this so that you could maybe do a calculation for the homeowner?
I think, in the sake of being fair, if they wanted to calculate and bring forth and say why the 24 works or does not work, and we can review it again at that point.
I don't want to be obstinate.
We can certainly continue it to review the 24.
Well, look, it's there at the moment.
Yeah, they're not asking for permission to do something, and they have to hurry.
Right.
So
yeah,
but there's no consensus.
Question on that you're giving time to answer, I presume, was already asked previously. True.
Correct.
So we're
the
going
the
over.
Just to go back and add some more information. Cutting out the asphalt was recommended at one point by engineering to comply before we even brought it forward.
Before we got here.
Yes.
And that was declined.
Without getting into too much detail, there were some other challenges
the
with that original request.
You chasing the contractor?
No.
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 What were the challenges?
There were some challenges between the building inspector and the contractor, and because of that, at one point, the building inspector, the morning this all happened, we got a call telling us that we had to move our parents out of the house at 7:30 in the morning.
They
you got people living in there. What are they doing living in there?
From the building inspector.
From the building inspector.
Was there no certificate of occupancy?
There was
Correct.
No certificate
Correct.
Of occupancy, but we were given approval verbally. Shame on us for not getting it in writing. Everything had been signed off on the card.
Just to be clear, you were given approval to move in stuff, not people.
No.
Yes.
That
is a fact. That is a fact the building inspector will swear to. Just to be clear.
I can't imagine a building inspector would ever let you
right.
occupy
there
a building without a CO.
There were live wires still, which is why he was concerned that people should not be in there at the time.
That's
on that.
So was it your contractor that said to you, it's okay to move in?
There were multiple. So the contractor told us that, yes.
Yeah.
But we've gone through this process all along wanting to do everything by the book.
Mm-hmm.
And we've worked very closely with everyone in town to make sure that we do everything by the book. There were multiple conversations that were had about all of this. That is the building contractor's information now, but it was our parents were living in there for a couple of weeks, and then the building inspector and the contractor had a dispute that weekend, and Monday morning at 7:30 a.m., we got the call.
But that's not material to this discussion in front of us today, or is it? How is it?
So my only point is, from a perspective of, we were told, oh, you can just cut it. That day was a bit of a hectic day, and when we realized that all of this was becoming a really big issue, we called up, we talked to people in the town, talked to the engineering department. They did suggest one option is to cut, and you know another option is to come to you guys and tell you what happened and see if it's reasonable to ask you for.
Do we know, Ryan, what we're talking about cutting, other than the obvious? There's a certain amount. There's 8 feet on the street.
Square footage wise, I can't give you that number, but I mean it's 8 feet if you want to go along the property line. Then it has to cut
cut back, and then it can taper back down to the 24 that's sitting at the right.
So I guess what I'm wondering, are we talking about cutting out a triangle, you know, that's 8 by 8 by 3? I mean, you know,
yeah.
I guess what I'm getting at, I'm trying to, and I'm saying this for your benefit.
Sure.
I mean, it's not our goal to have you not enjoy the use of your property that was put in place so that you could do what you did.
Right.
And it was strongly endorsed by town meeting and every other elected.
This is
official.
A very clever interpretation of the statute. It wasn't
yeah,
what we intended,
I mean,
but you know, I can't argue with it. It makes
no,
sense.
You, no, you can't argue with it at all. And you did play by the rules.
Yep.
And
you know, even here, like, we wanted to come before you to see if this was just something that was perhaps something that we could easily say, oh, it's really not that big a deal, don't worry about it. We don't know, we're homeowners, we don't go through this.
Of course,
we do it
yeah.
once in our lives.
Yeah.
So this happened. Do we really want to have to deal with the contractor to bring him back to cut the pavement? I don't know how much that's going to cost. Whatever. It seemed like a reasonable idea to come here and ask you guys.
Well,
if it's important to you, I understand.
Let's back
that.
Up.
We'll
first
be
of
happy
all,
to cut
the
it.
Contractor makes a unilateral decision to break the agreement of the code. Okay, so that's in my mind's eye. The cost needs to be borne by the person that committed the sin. Okay, I mean, I don't know how this all sorts, but that's just me thinking out loud.
Recourse, essentially, if there's
yeah.
a
Absolutely.
Mitigation factor.
It seems like there's recourse. And I guess I don't, you know, in my mind, if I did understand what this would look like, cut out to code and fully utilizing his property, you know, at the spot that would make sense, you know, 8 feet off that line, you know,
mm-hmm.
What are we really talking about? I mean, are we talking about cutting out a lane of traffic? I don't think so. I
right.
think we're talking about, there's a triangular piece
yeah.
here that is out of code.
Sure.
Okay? And I think it's worth this group, I'm just thinking out loud. I mean, everybody will decide together what that'll happen, but if I could wave a magic wand, I'd continue this and understand what that looked like cut out, and then try to make a decision whether or not, in order to play by the rules, we ask you to do that,
right.
or whether we say, okay, we can live with this, we understand what happened. And there's some matter of record as things go on in the future as to how we look at this.
Yeah.
I mean, I just got to be honest with you. When I drove up on the property and I went, this is already done. It's
yeah.
a little, you know, it's a little aggravating, actually, and I'm not aggravated with you. I'm aggravated
no,
with
trust
the
fact
me,
that
it's
had your contractor just
too.
Said, hey, you know, before I make this, you should probably go back to the town and ask. I think we'd be done by now. Because it'd be,
yeah.
you know, they
yeah.
present the evidence and we'd look at it.
And it probably would have been done by now.
Yeah.
Because it would have
right.
been asked for in advance
right.
and it would have
right.
been, and it would have been done. It might have taken an extra 2 weeks, but it's, and for my money, it's probably going to take an extra 2 weeks from now anyway. And if I looked at this, if I could look at that, you know, a drawing of what it's going to look like, and try to understand if you could, in a reasonable and fair way, continue to use your property, and you know, have your parents be able to drive their cars, you know, in a safe way,
right.
you know, into the garages. I mean, that's what I would hope would happen. Kind of where I would be interested. How did the rest of you feel about this?
I think you could actually map it out tonight. I mean, we could ask Ryan to
well,
go get
you
a dimension.
Could, I
couldn't. No, we could do it. You could.
I mean, I can
you
roughly approximate. Tell you it's somewhere around, I mean, if you want to say it's an 8 by 8 and half of that for a triangle, you're looking at 32
square feet.
That's very small.
Now, how would that work, though, from the street? Does it have to go like a straight line in? That first 8 feet?
Yes.
So it's not really a triangle, more of a...
If it arc, it doesn't have to be a straight line, I assume.
Right, but
to get to
maximize
okay.
the most amount for that area,
you
want to
get the
want to go straight.
You want to get the most of your current driveway
right.
in play.
Okay.
Can you
right.
bring up that other diagram?
I sure can.
Yeah, and show me what you're talking about when you said... I think my straight is different from your straight.
I now understand the drawing.
You're ahead of me.
So I think this is the existing side. This is the existing curb. This is a grass strip. This is the sidewalk, and this dimension is 8 feet.
You are roughly.
Roughly
yes,
8 feet.
Correct.
The existing arc
is 32 feet. So mentally divide this into thirds. Now, maybe that's a third, that's a third.
Is there a sidewalk there?
No.
It's shown here as
yes.
sidewalk.
There is, okay.
There's not grass though, is there?
It's shown here as grass.
Yes, there is a grass strip there.
Okay.
There's a grass strip.
It's a small tree lawn.
So I believe the answer is you preserve all of this work,
grass.
And what you do is excise a portion of hot top that extends from this point down over to this wall, and this is an approximate, it's not quite a rectangle, but it's whatever that arc is, I don't know.
Right.
That's the only thing you're removing, and the rest of this is entirely preserved. That meets the objectives of the town. That gives the homeowner 99% of what's already there without changes.
And the portion at the edge of travel way here may already be 24 feet, pretty close too. So it would actually start here.
These appear to be radial line from the center of the cul-de-sac. So somewhere over here in the center, these are all radial lines. Is that the way you measure it?
You mean as far as...
So if I move it over to here, it's a radius.
Correct.
Okay. So if I just arc it to a third, you're in this section here, you'd lose.
Right. If this piece here was arced out for a 24...
I'm trying to draw a PowerPoint. That was okay.
It would sort of come out on an angle like this.
Well,
does that make sense, that little square?
To be clear, this is coming at an angle up to the driveway here. So this would have to come parallel to that.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. So it would have to come in kind of a...
Right, it's more of a triangle than it is a...
Back to that point, Ryan, could that other line, is that obligated to extend into the street at the same angle that it emerges?
No.
Could it also be widened to accommodate?
So it could.
To the homeowner's point, this point today comes out to the street like this. Could that be, using that radius box, could that be there?
For the sake of
measuring. For the sake of measuring. So you'd add 2 feet here, but you might subtract here, but you'd make an easier egress and ingress.
As long as that 24 feet is maintained.
Is observed. But this line here doesn't have to be in this angle. This could be stretched this some other point to get
Correct.
Back to the center.
Correct.
So that would accommodate your point about ingress and egress. So you end up losing this little square here. You modify this to get you kind of a more natural entrance and allow you to get in here, and you get everything but this.
Yep.
Make sense?
Which is the way the original driveway went
right.
before we put a telephone pole here. The original driveway actually went out this way.
So we can have Ryan draw it, but that's kind of it.
What was the pole for the new building?
The
service, electrical service.
The old service to the main residence went through here.
Yeah.
And
had to relocate it.
So we had to put another pole here to be able to get the service up to the house without going over.
Without going over.
The structure.
I see.
Correct.
Would a continuation really change our ultimate decision here? I mean, we're going to deny the waiver, it sounds like, the way we're heading here, correct? Am I wrong?
Well, I mean there are five people to vote here, so I don't know the answer to that question.
Yeah, but are we creating in a motion the solution? Well, we just,
I think
are voting up and down on the...
You don't know. It's not your job to create a solution.
Right.
Not
so
job.
Just
no. solution, yeah.
So we're just voting up and down on this.
That's
thing.
Correct.
So.
I just wanted to explore the space, Ryan, mm-hmm. could operate with it and see if you get more
yeah.
symptomatic.
It might for me. Right. Look, I mean, this man took advantage of a bylaw that we put in place
right.
so that people could do this. He did it.
Yep.
Did it on his property.
Great.
You know, granted, you know, I mean... Some of us maybe didn't expect that exactly. They were expected in a different place. Okay. if there wasn't clarity, I mean, nothing was done inappropriately when it comes to the structure. As a matter of fact, to his point, it was done, you know, quite nicely. and it is nicely done, for sure. I mean, is the reaction... I mean, the driveway is wrong.
Yes.
It needs, should be denied.
Right.
I don't think there's any question about that. But at the same time, my sense is, I'm wondering if we deny it based on a look at the minimal impact in the event that, you know, he can't. I mean,
we can deny it, and if it comes back
deny it,
later,
they come right back.
We can look at it
so
and reconsider.
Denial impact.
is some waiting period. Do you know?
I don't think we have any language.
I don't think so either.
Stability.
So we could deny it, and then you could bring it
back
with a drawing,
yeah,
showing us what it would look like, a pro and a con of that, and
mm-hmm,
you know.
Or
I mean, in the meantime, you're using it.
Sure.
It's not compliant, but you're using it.
Yeah.
Well, and again, we want to do everything the right way. This
I know
was
you
done
do.
Wrong.
That's
and we're
clear.
Very sorry about that. We really are.
Yeah.
We want to do what's right here. So if the right thing to do is to fix it, we'll work with the contractor and we'll fix it. That's what I'm hearing.
Yeah, and my suggestion is if the contractor says, in all honesty, you know, I can't do 24, but I could do 26, then you should come back.
Yeah.
And present that evidence.
Right. But that's not before us, right?
Right.
That's either right. That's right. It's right now. It's over.
This,
yeah.
No, this, just so you understand, the proper order is you want to do something, it's a variance. You know, you come here to find out if that's okay.
Absolutely.
And as you saw a little while ago, you know,
yeah,
it was in advance.
Right.
And went, yeah, okay, go ahead, do that.
Yeah.
So generally, that's what happens.
Yeah.
If we set a precedent that says, oh, do whatever you want, and then the selectmen will just say yes, you know, because they want to be nice to the homeowners. Well, we do want to be nice to the homeowners, but that's not like a license to do whatever you want to do.
That's understood.
You know,
yeah.
I'm good.
Okay.
Move to close the hearing on the driveway variance, 61 Terrace Park.
Second.
So we ask for public input first?
We didn't. We've engaged the homeowner.
Is there any more?
Before we go to there, is there any more discussion before we close this hearing from this board?
Will there be discussion after we close the hearing? This is
I know that, but while the hearing is open and the public has the opportunity to comment.
Nope.
Nope.
The only comment to the homeowner is, again, John said it, in no manner do we trying to create an undue burden on the homeowner. This is a circumstance that happens with some regularity where there's a noncompliance that's brought before us, and we always struggle with, do you try to enforce the laws that are written? Or do you have a reason to provide a variance? In this case, the circumstance that, so you understand my mind, it turns my mind, is the fact that guidance was provided earlier and it was ignored. But again, this is not an attempt to put any undue burden on yourself. And, you know, our focus here is primarily not creating a behavior that then propagates to other individuals in the town.
Because there could be some serious impact to the other residents or curb appeal of people's properties later on, and so that's why the precedent is really important.
I do just want to say, it wasn't ignored. I feel it's a little harsh. We understood the recommendation.
Ignored by your contractor, I guess, is what you said, not you.
Oh.
The guidance to cut.
Okay. No.
The
initial 24
feet was by your.
Yes, that I totally agree with.
Okay.
He knew. He knows.
Yes.
And he made a decision. And he really didn't enfranchise you in that decision.
Right.
And that was willful.
Yeah.
That's his issue.
And we will deal with that.
Yeah. Any more comment from the public? Frank, anything else you'd like to say?
No, thank you for your time.
Okay.
There's been a motion to close.
Yeah, move to close.
Move to close, and there's a second?
Yeah.
Any discussion on the close? All those in favor?
Opposed? Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the 32-foot driveway at 61A Terrace Park.
Second. For the purpose of discussion.
Mm-hmm. Discussion?
All right, so walk me through this. If it's denied today, what happens next? They can actually reapply for the correct way they were supposed to do it before, all the while nothing's happening to the property.
Right. There's no enforcement.
Well,
right.
By denying them, they're supposed to have a 20-foot wide driveway.
Right.
But as a practical matter, they can come
right.
up with another solution before they just cut it back to 24 and bring
right.
it to you.
Right.
The board's not going to object to
well,
that.
You're going
to
do that work, and then you're going to, if it's done to 24, it gets done, and if
then you have to come back.
Right, and if it's like, well, you know, we can do it, but it's gonna be not 24, a little bit off, and here's why.
Yeah.
Then it's another hearing, and.
Right. May I just make a point of clarification?
Please.
It is winter time too, so.
Right.
Let's just keep that in mind, that we don't expect contractors to do any work in the winter time, nor would we expect them to get a good quality job done with asphalt.
Under the snow.
In the winter.
Well, just with the cold too, right? The asphalt is not gonna sit.
So there is a time period there before construction on the driveway would happen anyway.
But that's. Is there any jeopardy reporting them in with a no vote in terms of enforcement? Who would do any?
The Board of Selectmen would enforce anyway.
Yeah, okay.
So it's not like the building's inside of.
Fix it or come back and.
Yeah, I think.
This has no bearing on, for instance.
So just from a discussion standpoint, that's what I think, Barry, you hit it on the head. If this is a vote to reject the application, in my mind, it's with an understanding that we'll probably hear back from you.
Yes.
And that we can consider it at that time.
Right.
And that from an enforcement standpoint, to Ryan's point, I mean, winter's here.
Right.
I mean, it's gonna be 19 on Friday.
Covered
with snow. I mean, you're not cutting and putting hot top down, and then the next thing that's gonna happen is it's gonna have a foot of snow on it. So, I mean, from a practical standpoint, that makes no sense whatsoever. So, you know, you use it and, you know, understand that it's out of code and needs to be corrected, or either needs to be corrected or you have to come back and show us why it should.
Actually, is there any, if we're gonna vote this down, is there any evidence that we were gonna require that it's actually been fixed? Does he have to talk to Ryan or call the town? Or
well,
we just assume that it's gonna get done? Or
we're in charge of enforcement.
There's a non-compliance.
No.
Are we the driveway police? I don't
well,
know.
As your acting agent, we will monitor it.
Yes.
Come springtime, if no action has been taken,
mm-hmm.
as
one
far
way,
as
yeah.
coming
but
to the Board of Selectmen yeah. for to reapply or look for a different approval or correct it, then we'll
or send a letter. That
we'll address it.
My question was, if let's say he takes care of it, is there any reporting on his part that he's done it required, or
there would be reporting to the engineering office?
Yeah.
So that well,
you still
then
need
there
to
was compliance.
You still need to
yep,
sign
yep,
off
yep.
on the plan, correct? This plan's not signed off on.
The engineering office has not signed off on the certificate of occupancy. So, that being said,
which is
we don't
question.
Hold up occupancy.
Oh,
that's
right.
the building
okay.
inspector.
There's
right.
a letter
right.
from the
so,
plan from
right.
planning
right.
that says you can live there.
Okay.
The driveway's
wanna
a
make,
separate deal.
I want to make
okay.
sure that's
right.
well
so
established.
That's,
okay.
That is well established.
Right. The
in writing.
So you folks are back in there. Right?
The building inspector has the only authority to hold up the occupancy.
That's,
we do not.
That's a different
we're just
cap.
A sign off on his sheet,
right.
so he knows what's been done, what
yeah.
has not been done.
Gotcha.
And and Frank and his wife have a letter from the assistant town manager who supervises planning that clearly states that the occupancy is fine,
mm-hmm.
that the driveway is a separate issue.
Yeah.
Right. And indicates in the letter that it's going to come here. And so here we are, it's the 13th, and we're having this discussion, and then on we go from there.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no pending our results of that letter, that occupancy?
No, it doesn't
okay.
say that.
All right.
So
it says it's going to have to come here.
Motion has been made and seconded.
Any other discussion from the board? So this is to approve the 32-foot driveway. All those in favor? All those opposed? Okay. So.
Oh, sorry, I had to go through all this for 32 square feet.
We take in the interim period of time. I mean, we just have to take the rules.
But yeah.
You guys have a job to do, and I respect that very much. And we will look at this. We'll take your feedback. We will go deal with it. And
and yeah,
we're
yes.
at your disposal too. If you want to run anything by us before you go and spend too much,
we don't want you to spend a lot of money trying to figure this out. We want to help you figure it out and then figure out the best course of action.
Yes, John.
Bob, if this was street betterments, the town would have some active role to play. Is there any role for the town to play here on private property in this regard, or no? Thank you very much. Sorry for the time.
Yeah.
Motion to adjourn in order, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Are we done?
Yeah, we're
done.
We're done.
We finished everything.
Oh my
God.
We're trying to keep you on a record speed.
Seriously. You're trying to
Frank,
keep
thank
us
you
here
for coming here. And, you know, let's try to work together on this.
I appreciate that. Thank
all
you.
Right, thank you, Frank.
Thank you very
thank
much.
You. Thank you.
Yes, the motion.
Move that the Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting at 9:31.
Second.
So, any discussion on that? All
not,
in favor?
Not debatable.
Signatures.
Okay.
Wow.
That's right. Get us out of here. And you.